ओम अज्ञानतिमिरांधस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकय चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपः कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकं। नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्तस्वामिनिति नामिने। नमस्ते सरस्वतीदेवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषशून्यवादि पाश्चात्यदेशतारिणे। जय श्रीकृष्णचैतन्यप्रभुनित्यानन्द श्रीअद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौरभक्तवृंद। हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे, हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे, हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। सो टुडे वी हैव मेनी मेनी वर्सेस टू स्टार्ट रीडिंग फ्रॉम। वी विल बी रीडिंग फ्रॉम द 7th canto of Srimad Bhagavatam, because 7th canto deals with the pastime of Narsingadev and Prahlad Maharaj. In fact, the 7th canto deals with a topic called Uti. The 10 subject matters on the Srimad Bhagavatam, 10 different topics have been spoken over 12 cantos, and the 7th canto deals with a topic called as Uti or Utayaha. Utayaha means good and bad swabhav, shubh ashubh swabhav, auspicious and inauspicious natures. And it is quite fascinating that two personalities with opposite natures come face to face in this canto. Prahlad Maharaj represents shubh ichha or auspicious desires, auspicious inclination in life, pravritti or swabhav, nature. And Hiranyakashipu deals with ashubh ichha, inauspicious desires, inauspicious inclination in life, and very demoniac perspective. So either we can have shubh ichha or ashubh ichha. We can have shubh vasana or desires or ashubh vasana. As far as desires are concerned, inclination is concerned, our calling in life is concerned, either it could be auspicious or inauspicious. So two personalities having these two opposite natures come face to face, and we can see what happens between them. This is what happens in the 7th canto. This is one of the longest sections of Srimad Bhagavatam. The 10th canto deals with the pastimes of Krishna in Vrindavan, and we all know that it ultimately culminates on the peak of the mountain of Brajaras with the five chapters of the Rasa Leela, where Krishna sings and dances and reciprocates with the gopis of Vrindavan. And that is considered to be the Pancha Pran of the Srimad Bhagavatam, the five life airs of Srimad Bhagavatam. However, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who is Radharani himself, Krishna in the mood of Radharani, relished the 7th canto repeatedly with Gadadhar Pandit, who is the incarnation of Radharani. So it's interesting, Gadadhar Pandit, who is Radharani, is sitting with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, who's Radha and Krishna together at Tota Gopinath, and they sit and read Srimad Bhagavatam. So we would probably expect them to read the five chapters of the Rasa Leela, because Radha and Krishna, or Krishna in the mood of Radharani with Radharani, sitting and reading Bhagavatam. But it is described that they studied the 7th canto very deeply, which has the section of Prahlad Charitra, or the section of Prahlad Maharaj's surrender towards Narsingadev. So therefore, for Gaudiya Vaishnavas who even aspire for the lotus feet of Radha and Krishna in Vrindavan, sometimes this question could be asked: why should we worship Narsingadev? Why should I hear and read about Narsingadev when my inclination is towards Radha and Krishna, as a Gaudiya Vaishnav is? His Grace Pankajangri Prabhu, whom we very much miss today, because this is the first Narsingha Chaturdashi since the last 50 years that Pankajangri Prabhu is not at the service of Narsingadev in Mayapur in this world. Of course, he's in the service of Narsingadev in that world, but we feel supreme separation today. So His Grace Pankajangri Prabhu used to say, when he used to be asked that Radha Madhav is right in front of you, and you're in the land of Mayapur, the place of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, why would you worship Narsingadev? Why not worship Panchatattva or Ashtasakhi, Radha Madhava Ashtasakhi, the eight sakhis of Radha and Madhava. So His Grace Pankajangri Prabhu in so much humility used to say that to worship Radha and Krishna on the highway of Radha and Krishna, there are many speed brakes, there are speed breakers, there are many obstacles. So Narsingadev with his nails can uproot all those obstacles so that our pathway towards Radha Krishna Seva becomes cleared. So Narsingadev does the cleanup work of all the anarthas in our heart. He is very kind. He is bhaktavatsalaha. Ugra api anugra evayam. Although he is very ferocious for the demons, he has appeared not for ugra, but he has come as anugraha. He has come to give anugraha roop, as favor, mercy. So therefore we should study and hear about Narsingadev with this mood that it will help me make advancement towards Braj Bhakti, towards the lotus feet of Radha and Krishna. All the anarthas that I'm struggling with in my heart, they will be uprooted. So today is a very auspicious day for the whole world, especially for the devotees, because today, with the appearance day of Narsingadev, it is also the disappearance day of Hiranyakashipu. And this also shows, it extols the unparalleled glories of the devotion of the five-year-old Prahlad. So today's day is a day to pray to Narsingadev that, O Narsingadev, just like you appeared from a pillar, in Sanskrit the word for pillar is stamba, but stamba also means pride, because pillar stands tall and doesn't bow down before anyone. Therefore, pride is compared to a pillar. So O Narsingadev, just like you broke the stamba and destroyed Hiranyakashipu and protected the five-year-old Prahlad, my Lord, please appear in the assembly of my heart, which is ruled over by Hiranyakashipu. It is the assembly house of Hiranyakashipu. Please appear breaking the stamba, which means the pillar, but it also means pride. So please break the stamba of my heart and destroy the Hiranyakashipu. Hiranya means gold and Kashipu means bed. So Hiranya represents greed towards wealth, external wealth, and also false ego, internal wealth in the material state. And Kashipu refers to laziness, sleeping on the bed, or it could also mean lust. So I am struggling with Hiranyam and Kashipu Pravritti. I am struggling with greed towards wealth, paradravyeshu. I'm struggling towards the wealth of other men, because you know, in the world that we live in, to make more profit means someone else has a loss. We have to take somebody's wealth through schemes. So which means you must be interested in another man's wealth so that you can take it from him, and he has a loss but you have a profit. This is considered to be Hiranya Pravritti. And Kashipu Pravritti means to consider the opposite sex as the source of pleasure. So my Lord, please break the pillar, the stamba of my pride, and destroy the Hiranya Pravritti and the Kashipu Pravritti in my heart. And although my devotion for you is only like a five-year-old child, Prahlad. It's, you see, in the picture of Prahlad Narsingadev, Hiranyakashipu looks very huge, but Prahlad looks very small. So our devotion is like that. It's just like a small creeper. But the anarthas that we have amassed is like Hiranyakashipu. But my Lord, I have faith in you. Please break the stamba, the pride of my heart. Appear in the assembly of Hiranyakashipu like king. Destroy and rip apart the Hiranya Pravritti and the Kashipu Pravritti. And please protect the tender Prahlad-like Pravritti of devotion in my heart. So today, this should be our prayer. And with this as the intention, this as our prayer, this as the goal, we start today's discussion. Of course, today is the day of fasting, so there's no break for breakfast. So with that, I would seek your permission to go a little over time, because today is a festive occasion. So we'll read little and hear little from the seventh canto, the very, very beautiful section of Prahlad Charitra. We will be reading many, many verses. Very specifically, we will start off from the fifth chapter and then go towards the eighth chapter where Narsingadev appears. Of course, sixth and seventh chapters of the seventh canto deal with the instructions of Prahlad Maharaj, so we will not take that here. We'll just go through the story and different beautiful points that Srimad Bhagavatam explains himself. As we go verse by verse, we will see how Srimad Bhagavatam explains. So we will start off from the section of 7.5. In fact, the fifth chapter is where Prahlad Maharaj and Hiranyakashipu are talking to each other. So it's a very interesting section. And we'll see, we'll come to 38. Yeah, 38. Okay. So the context here is Hiranyakashipu has sent Prahlad to Shanda and Amarka, who are the sons of Shukracharya, who is the Daitya Guru. And Prahlad Maharaj is learning from them. So Hiranyakashipu thinks that Guru Tattva for Prahlad should be Shanda and Amarka, because Shanda and Amarka are the sons of Shukracharya, the teachers of Prahlad in the Daitya Gurukul. So you can imagine what the syllabus would be. You can imagine what kind of daily schedule they would be following and what kind of routine they would be following. It's it's for the pleasure of a demon called Hiranyakashipu. And it's headed by Shanda and Amarka, who are the sons of Shukracharya, who is the Daitya Guru. So you can imagine. And there all the students are studying. And Prahlad Maharaj is also one such student there. Hiranyakashipu is asking Prahlad, what have you learnt from your teachers? And Prahlad Maharaj remembers his Gurudev Narada Muni. He remembers. Soham katham na visruje tava bhritya sevam. Prahlad Maharaj is remembering how his Gurudev Narada Muni spoke to him while Prahlad was in the womb. Narada Muni had so much compassion that he was ready to preach to someone whom he had not seen. Can we imagine? We talk about preaching in this world and we say, Jare dekhe tare kaho Krishna upadesh. That whomever we see, we should speak about Krishna. But look at Narada Muni's compassion. He was speaking Krishna katha to someone whom he had not even seen while Prahlad was in the womb. So Prahlad Maharaj has a lot of Guru Nishtha because his Gurudev had so much love for him. Narada Muni did not even know how Prahlad looks. He does not know the pravritti of Prahlad Maharaj. He has nothing, no clue about Prahlad Maharaj except for the fact that he knows that he's going to be a great devotee. Because we know when Indra came to kill the child of Kayadhu, it was Narada Muni who stopped and protected her and her child. So in Narada Muni's ashram, Narada Muni is speaking to Kayadhu, the mother of Prahlad. And Prahlad Maharaj in the womb is listening. So he's completely fixed on this fact that my Gurudev is Narada Muni. My Path Pradarshak Guru is Narada Muni. My Shiksha Guru is Narada Muni. And he has taught me about the Bhagavat Parampara. So he's like my Diksha Guru. I may have not seen him. He may have not seen me. But anyway, the connection of the Guru and disciple from Guru's side is out of compassion. And from disciple's side is out of hearing. So Prahlad Maharaj heard. So when Hiranyakashipu asked him, where did you learn all this from? And is this what, you know, your guru taught you? Your guru, I have employed your guru, and is this what your guru teaches you? The word guru means gushabdastu andakara syad rushabdha tannirodhaka andakara niroditva guru iti abhidhiyat. The word guru, according to the Advaitaraka Upanishad, means he who can, gushabdastu andakara syad. Gu means darkness, and ru means removal. So he who can remove the darkness of andhakar or tamas in one's consciousness, such a person is called guru. So Prahlad Maharaj was thinking, Shanda and Amarka, they are filled with darkness themselves. What can they remove? So the true guru is Narada Muni. So when Hiranyakashipu asked, where did you learn all this from? Is this what your guru taught you? And who gave you this mati? The mati with which you are arguing with me in the fifth chapter, you can see. Prahlad Maharaj, when he's asked by Hiranyakashipu, he speaks about bhakti repeatedly, once, twice, thrice. Then Hiranyakashipu loses his cool and he says, where did you get all your mati from? Where are you getting all this intellect? So first Prahlad Maharaj replies in a negative way. Prahlad Maharaj says, you are a griha asakta vyakti. You're a person who is very attached to household life. And that too, not a grihastha, griha medhi. So people like you cannot understand. So ideally you know, you should not ask. Sridhar Swami in his commentary, he writes, Astha Niyam Varta. You may feel I am polluted, O Father, but I have to tell you very honestly, this mati, Krishne mati astu, that the blessings that the sadhus give, that may your mati always be with Krishna, this kind of mati will not rise for someone who's only thinking of pleasure coming from household life. You think I am polluted, but honestly, this mati that I have is difficult for people like you. So how to get it? He says, unless one bathes in the foot dust of great Vaishnavas, Nishkinchananam, till the time one doesn't bathe in the foot dust of Nishkinchana Bhaktas, pure Vaishnavas, till then this mati will not rise. So you cannot understand. So as soon as Hiranyakashipu hears this, he picks up Prahlad according to the Bhagavatam and throws him off his lap. And not just that, he loudly shouts, he said, kill this fellow, kill this guy. What does he think of himself? He's talking about mati, he's talking about intelligence, and he's saying that I am Griha Asakt. Does he even know how much austerity I have performed before he was born? How much austerity I performed at the Mandarachala Parva? Does he even know about it? He was in his mother's womb. And he just comes out, listens to four or five people and reads a few books and talks to me about austerity. He's talking about sense control to me. He's talking about what is pollution and what is not and who's attached to family life. I could give up this whole kingdom. And I went and stood there on one leg. I raised my arms and by the fire of my intensity, I was burning the 10 directions. There was an anthill formed on me. I had not drunk a drop of water or eaten a grain of rice. I had not had anything. The demigods were trembling. They thought it's just an anthill. But then they realized this fire is coming from within the anthill. It must be something really great. And then they had to go to Brahmaji, the creator of this material universe. And he came and sprinkled some sacred water. And that's how I've become who I am. I was so great. And I'm greater now by that benediction. And this son, what does he know? What does he know about austerity? He lives in my kingdom, eats the food that I give him. And he talks about austerity. He talks about how to get this mati and that I am attached. Kill him. Here is Prahlad Maharaj speaking for his father's benefit. The absolute truth, uncompromising truth. But Hiranyakashipu yells by saying that in this world we see, in this world, we see sometimes another person's son will be more beneficial to us. We would be dying in the hospital and someone else will give blood. Our own son will be in another country. No, I am not able to come, whether it's visa consideration or whether it is this or that, whatever it may be. We see in this world, our own sons will be in another part of the world. But someone else will help. Someone else will give life. Hiranyakashipu says, sometimes we see another man's son seems to be more beneficial than our own son. And the example given is when you have to take help of natural herbs, when we are not keeping, we are in a disease state. We have to pick herbs from the plants and then we have to use them. Now, if you see the herbs from the shrubs or the plants, they are not humans, but they're more beneficial than humans because what can humans do around? The Vaidyaraj, the human doctor comes and says, use a vanaspati. So Hiranyakashipu is using proper logic to say sometimes people from other species also, like the plants and the herbs, they can be more beneficial to us than even our own men. And on the other hand, we see sometimes there is a dangerous disease which is growing in our own body. There are lumps which are formed in our own body. And just so that it doesn't spread, you have to scoop it out. And sometimes you have to, cut a limb. You have to cut the feet. Gangrene, you have to amputate the leg, right? So Hiranyakashipu is saying, my own son, I cannot be biased towards him and say that, oh, he's my son, because sometimes when there is an improper illness or a growth in the feet, you'll have to cut your own feet. Yes, you like your feet, but you like your pran more than your feet. So to save your life, you have to cut your feet or, chop your arm off. But on the other hand, the herbs can be more useful. So others are more useful to me. They agree to, what intelligence is than my own son. I don't know how he's even born like this. Kill him. And when Hiranyakashipu gives this order, long-standing order to all of his men, Bhagavatam describes Hiranyakashipu's men were anyway with demoniac blood. They were born out of asuric pravritti. They were born out of lust. Their parents did not have, you know, proper garbhadhan, sanskar, and things like that. They were, didn't take approval from their Gurudev with proper astrological timing. Nothing. They were just born out of lust. So anyway, they have a demoniac inclination inbuilt in them. Demoniac habits. They were eating meat and drinking. And so Hiranyakashipu's men were demoniac, not just with the point of preconception. They were demoniac in the lifestyle. They were demoniac in the clothes that they wore. They were demoniac in the food that they ate and the things that they drank. And they were demoniac with the desires that they had of winning over everything and conquering and siding with our friends and killing the enemies. And they were demoniac with the intentions of lust and anger and greed and pride and envy. And they were demoniac with their past history of killing. They love to kill. They love to murder. They love to hunt. And now they have an order from the king to do it. So there's no stopping. It's like the government has given an order. Do something that you like to do. Something that you're born to do. Something that you love to do. Something that you get paid to do. Now the government has given you an order. So just go and enjoy. So we start reading now from 39. So Canto 7, Chapter 5, Text 39. So I'll be reading through. I request the devotees, you can also read with me. You can have a Srimad Bhagavatam with you, or you can open up the Veda base. Canto 7, Chapter 5, entitled Prahlad, the Saintly Son of Hiranyakashipu, Text 39 onwards. You can see what kind of torture Prahlad Maharaj goes through. This is certainly something very inspiring. You know, we can take a lot of... lot of hope. We can seek a lot of hope. For small things in life, we complain. We start practicing bhakti, and for small things, we complain. He did this to me. Why did he do this to me? Why? How can she say this to me? Now look what 5-year-old Prahlad goes through from the lips of Shukadeva Goswami, repeating what Narada Muni, Devarishi Narada, is speaking. So the seventh canto is a nested conversation. We can see Narad Muni is speaking to Yudhishthir Maharaj at the Rajasuya Yajna, and that same conversation Shukadev Goswami repeats to Parikshit Maharaj on the banks of the Ganga, and then that Sutta Goswami repeats to Shaunakadi Rishis at the Naimasharanya assembly. So all great sages are listening. Thousands and thousands of people have heard this section and felt so much inspired. 5-year-old Prahlad Maharaj is the youngest Mahajan out of the 12. Swayambhu, Narada, Shambhu, Kumara, Kapila, Manu, Prahlado, Janako, Bhishmo, Bali, Vaya, Sakhi, Vayam. The four Kumaras were grown up, but they looked 5-year-old. But Prahlad was 5-year-old. So you can see this is very inspiring. Let's start. Nairtaste samadhishtha bharta vaishula panayah tigmadamshtra karalasya stamra shmashru shiroruha. In these two verses, the appearance of the men of Hiranyakashipu has been described. So, Nairtaste Samadhishtha, when they were instructed like this by their king, Bharta, by their master, Shulapanayaha, they immediately took, they became Shulapani. You know, Trishul. Shula means like a spear, something which has a spike. So, because it has three, you call it Trishul. Shul means a sharp-edged, you know, spear. And Pani means hand. Panayaha, plural, has been used here. So, Shula Panayaha, they, in many hands, they took up their spear. So, one meaning is each of them had many hands. So, they picked up spear on all of their hands. Or all of them, in their individual hands, they picked up. Shula Panayaha. Or another meaning could be they had so much anger that they've started picking up multiple spears with the same hand. So the plural sense has been used. And Tigma Damshtra Karalasyas. Bhagavatam describes they were not just picking up spear, they were picking up club, they were picking up bows and arrows, and you can imagine sword, all the different weapons have been picked up. And how was their mouth and appearance? Mouth was wide open. With teeth, tigma damshtraha, very sharp, dangerous teeth. They were making some sounds also. And tamra shmashru. The word shmashru means mustache and beard. So tamra, it was in a reddish copper complexion. You know, it was like a red copper beard. You know, that was the kind of complexion of the hair. And shiroruha, the hair on the head was all standing up. It was not properly combed and taken care. And nadanto bhairavam nadam. Nadanto, they were also making some sounds. Bhairavam nadam, as if, you know, something very tamasic. Chindi, chindi, bhindi, bhindi, iti vadinaha. They were saying chindi and bhindi, which means chop him, cut him, kill him, burn him. You know, these kind of words they were using. Nadanto means, nadanto bhairavam nadam means nadam. They were making sounds. And asinam cha ahanan shulaihi prahladam sarvamarmasu. And then they started attacking Prahlad. How was Prahlad? Sarvamarmasu. He was very, very soft. Marma means very soft. Sarvamarmasu. On all the soft parts of his body, shulaihi, with plural again used, with many, many spears and many, many weapons, they started attacking him. So you can imagine from Prahlad is sitting, you can imagine Prahlad sitting with folded palms, 5-year-old little tender bodied child, tender hearted, tender bodied. You can imagine how his you know, neck would be, his chin would be, his cheeks would be, his chest would be, his palms, hands, feet, everything very soft, very tender. So on sarva marmasu, the word sarva has come, which means on all parts of their body, at the same, on parts of Prahlad's body, at the same time, from all directions, they were attacking. On the chest, somebody was poking the spear on the chest. Somebody was poking it on the stomach. Somebody was keeping it on the neck. Someone was trying to pluck his eyes out. Someone was trying to put it into his ear. But what is happening? What is happening to Prahlad Maharaj? Pare brahmani anirdeshye bhagavati akhilatmani yuktatmani aphala asan apunyasya eva satkriya. In fact, in the Mahabharat, Arjuna speaks to Yudhishthir Maharaj and he gives the example of Prahlad Maharaj. Arjuna is speaking about Prahlad Maharaj to Yudhishthir Maharaj in the Mahabharat regarding the battlefield of Kurukshetra. He says, O older brother Yudhishthir Maharaj, Arjuna is speaking, my situation on the battlefield of Kurukshetra was like Arjuna. Was like Prahlad. Why? When Prahlad was sitting, there were arrows and swords and weapons and spears coming from all directions. But it did not even scratch his skin. Just like Narsingadev, Lord Vishnu was protecting Prahlad from all directions and not even one scratch came on his skin through all the attacks, constantly through all of them at all times. Arjuna is telling Yudhishthir Maharaj, similarly, Krishna Partha Sarathi protected me on the battlefield of Kurukshetra. My situation was like Prahlad, says Arjuna. And Narsingadev, in the form of Krishna, was protecting me. Although I saw spears going through, I saw swords going through, I saw shields going through, I saw arrows and bows being throwing around. I saw so many people using their clubs. It would come close to my body and without a single scratch, it would become nishfala bhavet. It will become completely fruitless. The word nishfala has come here, or afala, fruitless. So when Prahlad Maharaj used to be attacked by all of these demons, the weapons, they used to throw the spear from a distance and it used to come close. And by the tej, the effulgence, the as if there was something protecting. Nobody saw what was protecting. But as if there was some protection, like a kavacha, it all touched and it fell down to the ground. Who was protecting? Bhagavati Akhilatmani. That Supreme Lord who's present in everyone is also present in the weapons. Look how beautifully Shukdev Goswami is speaking. Pare Brahmani, that Supreme Lord in whom Prahlad Maharaj was meditating, on whom he was completely absorbed and remembering. That Bhagavati, that Supreme Lord, Akhilatmani, he's present in everyone and everything. He's also present in those weapons. He's present in the demons, he's present in Prahlad, but he's also present in those weapons. So although the weapons were thrown by the demons, the weapons were controlled by Krishna, by Narsingadev, by Vishnu, and they came close to Prahlad and as if they were failing in potency, as if gravity suddenly increased, they would fall to the ground by Prahlad Maharaj's unparalleled bhakti. And when all the attempts failed, then you can see in 43, they all came to Hiranyakashipu. And they told Hiranyakashipu that, well, this is not working out. We are trying for a long, long time. For hours, we are spending every day from all directions trying to poke him and kill him. But nothing's happening. There's no drop of blood. There's no scratch even to his skin. Something is going wrong. We are using the sword to chop off his neck. We are using the arrows, very sharp arrows, to go through his body. We are using swords at the same time. We are trying to slam his head with club on the top of the head. But somehow, not one weapon tip is touching his body. Something is wrong. Something is going wrong. So Hiranyakashipu was approached by all these demons. Hiranyakashipu said, "Don't worry. We have other ways also. This is not the only way. We have other ways." So you can see in 43 and 44, what are the other things that they did on a 5-year-old Prahlad? The first thing that they did is Diggajaihi. Diggaja. Now we know the word Diggaj. Many times we use that word in Hindi also, in Marathi also. Diggaj. We call Diggaj for someone who's a very big hero, someone who's very great. But in Sanskrit, the word Dik means direction, Disha. And Gaja means elephant. So directional elephants. You can imagine elephants in all directions. So Dik means directions and Gaja. And it's not singular. Gajena Gajabhyam Gajaihi. The plural has been used. Dik Gajaihi. So Bahuvachan, plural, has been used to say many, many elephants were employed from all directions, from behind, from ahead, from the sides. Elephants were even dropped from the top on him from all directions. And plural means multiple directions, one elephant each, or multiple elephants in multiple directions, or it could also mean multiple attempts in killing him with elephants to crush him. And this used to be a custom. You can see even in Krishna Leela that Kuvalayapid was used in Mathura. A mad elephant was used. So this used to be a tradition of killing. Bring in a mad elephant, and one elephant is enough. But here, many, many elephants from many, many directions, many, many times. But that was not working. When that failed, they came to Hiranyakashipu and said, "This is also failing. Somehow the elephants are coming close and they are moving away. They are moving. The mahout on the elephant is to push the elephant so that the elephant gets angry." And the elephant used to run towards Prahlad to crush him under the feet, and he would look at Prahlad, and somehow he would turn as if there was fire. Imagine if there are if you try to push an elephant next to fire, the elephant will try to move away because the elephant knows he will get burnt. So as if Prahlad was like a forest fire in one form. The elephants never went close. They were infuriated, but they would go close and just turn. When that failed, the next thing that has been described by Shukadev Goswami is, he says, Dandashukendreihi. Dandashuka means snakes, very powerful snakes. Dandashukendreihi. Again, plural has been used. Very, very powerful, poisonous, venomous snakes used to be used. And they, in fact, Hiranyakashipu was so heartless. He used to trap Prahlad in a room filled with the snakes, powerful snakes, Dandashukaihi, very, very powerful snakes. They used to be venomous, poisonous, and most importantly, Hiranyakashipu used to keep them hungry for many, many days, so that as soon as you put Prahlad there, all the snakes can strangulate him and bite him and start tearing him into pieces and even swallow him, perhaps. So, and again here, plural has been used. So many, many snakes. And each snake trying to bite on different parts of the body, into the eye, into the hands and the feet and the neck and the chest. And they all had red eyes with anger. You can imagine if snakes are used by Hiranyakashipu, what kind of snakes they would be. In Satya Yuga, that too. Not some water snakes, or not some small snake found in the backyard. No, we're talking about real, real snakes which can swallow even deer, gulping down the throat, that kind of snakes. But when they would go close to Prahlad, they would try to reach to bite him. They would again face away as if there was a fire there. That also failed. So all the demons, they came back running to Hiranyakashipu and said, "Now what to do?" So then Hiranyakashipu said, "Don't worry, we have another technique." So we have to understand, when we are reading Bhagavatam, each of those phrases are steps taken by Hiranyakashipu. First, then that is practiced for many, 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 many days. When that fails, they come back, then the next phrase. Of course, in the interest of time, Shukadeva Goswami tells all of them quickly. But we have to understand while reading, each of them need emphasis. So when Diggajaihi fails, the elephants fail, the snakes fail, what to do now? So they come back to Hiranyakashipu. Hiranyakashipu says, "Oh, that is also failing." So now we have Abhichar. What does Abhichar mean? Following the Vedic mantras. Just like Durvasa Muni did. Durvasa Muni, when he had to curse Ambarish Maharaj, he chanted Vedic mantras and he tried using tantric performances. In fact, the Vishnu Puran describes in this section that Shanda and Amarka chanted Maran mantras so that Prahlad dies by the power of those mantras. Very, very toxic. You can imagine, and these days also, people, even in the 21st century, when everything is so advanced in science and technology, and superstitions and black magic is supposed to be almost extinct, even now we can see in villages many times people use tantric performances, they use black magic, they use the dark side of hypnotism and the hidden sciences. So here Hiranyakashipu, being a Asura Shiromani, was using tantric mantras to kill Prahlad. He got in exorcists who are expert in invoking ghosts and also taking off ghosts. So he wanted to bring in ghosts into the body of Prahlad, chant mantras so that Uchatanatva mantra, so that Prahlad will forget, he will lose his mental balance, so that he will act out of his character. But what happened? That also failed. The mantras were having no effect on his body because Prahlad Maharaj was folding his palms and constantly, without deviation, remembering the lotus feet of the Supreme Lord. Sometimes our heart can melt remembering the dedication of Prahlad Maharaj. We get one distraction and we forget to chant. Some distraction and then we complain. Is this even devotion? Do we call ourselves devotees with this kind of nishtha? Something that we don't plan happens, or something that we expect doesn't happen. Immediately we say, "Oh, the only thing I asked Krishna was this, and Krishna can't even give me that. Why does God do this?" We see people speak like that. That is Asurik Pravritti. That is to doubt the Supreme Lord. But devotee means Prahlad Maharaj. In fact, in the seventh canto, you can see Narad Muni, when he introduces Prahlad Maharaj with his qualities, in the previous chapter, in the fourth chapter of the seventh canto, Narad Muni says, "Prahlad Maharaj is a devotee of such high class caliber that in all assemblies, at all times, in all places and circumstances, people will speak about Prahlad." Prahlad's devotion is unparalleled. Gurudev, Narad Muni, is speaking about the Sat Shishya, the first class disciple, Prahlad Maharaj. So even the Abhicharana mantras, the Vedic mantras, the tantric mantras, the exorcist attempts, nothing of that worked. They came back and they told Hiranyakashipu, "We are trying for days and weeks, but nothing is happening. The ghosts are coming and attacking our consciousness in dreams. We are getting tormented by those ghosts because, according to the tantric performance, when the person whom you want to attack doesn't get attacked, then the ghost comes back and attacks the person who is invoking." It's a very dangerous side of negativity. So when Abhicharana mantras done, the Vedic mantras don't work, then what to do? Came back to Hiranyakashipu. Hiranyakashipu said, "We have another technique. Avapatanaihi. Avapatanam means to throw. Just like in Hindi we say, patan hona, to fall. Avapatan means to take someone up and then throw them from there." And again, if you see, all of this have been used in Bahuvachan, in plural usage. Diggajaihi, dandashukendraihi, abhichara avapatanaihi. All of them, multiple attempts, or in every attempt, multiple people doing at the same time. Avapatanaihi means to take him on the top of cliffs and throw him down. So many mountains have been used to take him one peak after another. Some say Simhachalam in Andhra Pradesh is one place where Prahlad Maharaj was protected by Vishnu. He was thrown from there and he was protected. So many beautiful, wonderful places are there like that. And Prahlad Maharaj, even when he used to be carried on top of the mountain, and they used to tell him, now also you have chance, change your decision, talk properly to your father, accept his supremacy, give up the meditation on Vishnu. Prahlad would not speak a word. Unflinching faith that my Lord will protect me. Not one inch of deviation. Prahlad is folding his palms and remembering Mahavishnu. Remembering the Lord of his life who is giving him breath. The Lord of his life who is giving him the energy, giving him the protection, giving him the Ojas Shakti, giving him the Tejas Shakti, giving him that Vishnu who gave him Narada Muni. He's remembering. Not one scratch on the body and not one scratch in his meditation. Taken on top, Prahlad, look down. This is the depth. Prahlad is looking down. And in all directions, he sees only his Lord. On the top of the mountain also, and in the depths of the valley also. They pick him up and they throw him from the top of the mountain. And Vishnu's arms held Prahlad. It wasn't even a bed of petals. A bed of petals would also feel, sharp compared to the palms of the Supreme Lord. When Prahlad used to be thrown, Mahavishnu used to protect him. And Avapatanaihi, repeatedly. Dear devotees, these words of Srimad Bhagavatam are to be read with great attention and feeling. How beautifully Shukadeva Goswami is describing every detail. Now, we could say on one hand, why should Shukadeva Goswami describe all these atrocities that have been performed on a Vaishnava? Generally, it is very painful to hear and read and imagine this. But this has been done only to extol the glories, to spread the glories of Prahlad Maharaj. That how we complain over small things and how Prahlad is suffering for such a long time with no blaming, no complaining, no criticism against anyone at any time. Only seeing Krishna to be the doer of everything. Just like Jadabharat. Jadabharat was also like this. Whether he was criticized by Rahugana Maharaj in the fifth canto for not properly carrying the palanquin, or when Rahugana Maharaj jumped off the palanquin and held the feet of Jadabharat and said, you are like my Gurudev, you are someone mystical, who are you? Please tell me. Whether in criticism or in glorification, Jadabharat did not move an inch. Then he was carried by the tribes to be offered as bali to goddess Durga. So his body was oiled, he was given proper bath, he was given a big feast just before offering his head. Even at that time, Jadabharat did not have any happiness. And when they tied him up to kill him, he didn't have any fear. Then goddess Durga broke open from her own deity, and with the axe that was there in the hand of her own servants, she killed all her servants because they were trying to attack Jadabharat. Even at that time, he didn't have a lot of happiness. He was constantly absorbed in remembering the Supreme Lord. Bhaja Hure Mana Shri Nandanandana Abhaya Charanaravindare Durlabha Manava Janama Satsange Tarahu Ei Bhavasindure. Govinda Das, very great poet, he has said that if you remember Krishna, you will become fearless. This is why our Prabhupada is called Abhaya Charanaravinda. He who's at the feet of the fearless Lord, the lotus feet. When, after repeated throwing from the top of the mountain, still Prahlad survived, they came back and said, now what to do? Hiranyakashipu said, we have other ways also. Mayabhi. Mayabhi means we will now create some illusory arrangements. Like, for example, we will try to scare him. Here he knows what's happening. Okay, weapons are being pushed through his body, elephants are attacking, snakes are biting, the height of the mountain. He knows all of that. Let's make arrangements where he's not able to predict what's happening. Like we will make it as if it's land, but when he steps on, he will realize it's actually a deep valley. Or we can make him feel as if it's water, and when he steps in, it should be fire. Or he should walk thinking that it's a room, but when he enters, he will see there are tigers and elephants there. So illusion, that which is not, we will try. None of that worked on Prahlad. Prahlad was still remembering the Supreme Lord. They all came back and told Hiranyakashipu, that is also not working. Now what to do? The next word in the Bhagavatam is Sannirodhaihi. Sannirodha. Nirodha means to stop. Sam means completely. So to completely stop him, again Bahuvachan has been used. Mayabhihi is also Bahuvachan. Plural usage, sannirodhaihi is also Bahuvachan, plural usage. So many, many times each of this have been performed. Otherwise, some of them would be in plural and some of them would be in singular. But Shukadev Goswami is very particular about case and number. What number, how many times it has happened. And in Sanskrit, you unlike English, in English you have singular and plural. But in Sanskrit, you have singular, dual and plural. So plural is used when it's more than twice. So you can imagine all of this has been performed minimum twice. Because only then plural can be used grammatically. So sannirodhaihi. Nirodha means to stop, sam means completely. So to block him, to stop him, which means to trap him in a cave, to trap him in a room with poisonous smell, like a gas chamber. To stuff him in a place where there is no breathing space, there is no moving space, no breathing possible. This is the meaning of sannirodhai, and repeatedly, so that he should die. And closing and putting him in a room where he has no food, no water, no window, nothing to see, no air, no breathing possible. And on the other hand, you put something just like when you're a mosquito, you have to knock off the mosquitoes, ripple them. Then they put some mosquito repellent, you know, smoke or some coil or something like that. So where are they getting all those ideas from? The ideas come from Hiranyakashipu. He did that for Prahlad Maharaj. Stuffing Prahlad Maharaj in a small place with dangerous poisonous smoke and making him there. It's soundproof, so even if he cries, nobody will be able to hear, nobody will go and help. And he's the only person. And the whole kingdom, headed by Hiranyakashipu, their only intention is to murder him and kill him. Can you imagine how demoniac the father has to be to do that to his own son? So this is sannirodhaihi. When that also failed, the word cha means that also failed. Then, garadanaihi. Now, dan means to give. Gara or garala means poison, halahal, very, very thick, viscous poison. That kind of poison, you can't have anything before it to protect you from the poison. And after having that poison, you can't have anything after that to protect you from the poison. Because sometimes, you see, when there's a snake bite, you can try to do something in the fastest time possible to kick that poison out. You can inject another kind of poison, which will nullify the previous snake poison. But this kind of poison, gara danaihi, again plural has been used by Hiranyakashipu. He used so many ways of poisoning Prahlad Maharaj. He gave poison. What happened to Prahlad? He drank. He saw the Supreme Lord in that poison also. He drank it like charanamrit and nothing happened. Yadrishi bhavana yasya siddhir bhavati tadrishi. Depending on how much faith we have on the Supreme Lord, that's how much siddhi we attain in the path of bhakti. So Prahlad Maharaj, when we are given charanamrit, I'm talking about myself, we lack faith in charanamrit. We lack faith in prasad. Because namo brahmanya devaya, what is that verse? Mahaprasade govinda. Today's fasting, I forgot the mantra for prasadam also. So, Mahaprasade Govinde Nama Brahmani Vaishnave Swalpa Punya Vatam Rajan Vishwasanaiva Jayate. Those who are Swalpa Punya Vatam means those who are pious, Swalpa, those who have very little, Vishwasanaiva Jayate. For someone who has very little piety in their spiritual bank balance, they will not have faith. Mahaprasade in the Mahaprasad, Govinde in Krishna, Nama in the holy name, Brahmani in the Brahmanas, and Vaishnave in the devotees. Swalpa punyavatam rajan, O king, Vishwasa naiva jayate. For someone who has very little piety, they don't have faith. So people like me, when I say even charanamrita or prasad, I may take it for granted. But Prahlad Maharaj, even in garalam, even in poison, different kinds of poison given many, many times in different occasions. He saw only Charanamrit there and he drank and nothing happened. When that also didn't work, then abhojanaihi, he was given no water. Bhojana means food. Abhojanaihi, no water, no grain of food, nothing. But Prahlad, they were thinking Prahlad Maharaj will become weak, but he was just chanting Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Constant chanting and constant remembrance, undeviated. No weakness, nothing. Absolutely no weakness. When all of this failed, then they came back to Hiranyakashipu and said, one more verse is over. You see, we tried all of that, nothing is happening. Hiranyakashipu said, we have more ways, don't worry. Then he started Hima. Hima means dip him in cold ice water. Hima means snow or ice. So dip him in cold ice water. And people should stand in all directions. If he tries to come out, push him in. Let him freeze to death. Nothing happened. When that didn't happen, Vayu, wind storms. When there is natural wind storms, you know, face him. We will all be inside, but he should be tortured. This is text 40, after 43, now this is text 44. Vayu, when there are wind storms, he should be tortured in those wind storms so that he has no help. Again, nothing happens. Then Agni. Agni, fire. He is pushed in pots of boiling oil. Flames of fire are coming. He's thrown in lava where nobody can escape. We can't even get close to lava. And Prahlad Maharaj is pushed in a pot where oil is boiling, burning, flames of fire from beneath and from the top. The pot is also very hot, fire underneath, fire inside. And Prahlad Maharaj is pushed inside and people are standing with spears as if it is hell. For what? For devotion. He is being treated for his transcendental devotion in the way that people with sins get treated in hell. Now, is this justice? No, this is injustice. But Prahlad Maharaj didn't file any complaint. He didn't file any petition. We always complain. Well, is this what I deserve? Is this how they should talk to me? But look, Prahlad Maharaj is struggling so much. Of course, he was not struggling, but the attempts to make him struggle are so much. Agni. When that failed, then Salilaihi. Salilam means water. Again, plural has been used. So, all of them. Hima, Vayu, Agni, Salilaihi. All of them in Bahuvachan. All of them many, 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 many times. Salilam means water. So, they used to take him and throw him into the ocean. Deep oceans where there are tides. So that either he will drown to death. Or the word Salilam can also mean aquatic animals which are found in the water oceans, in the deep oceans. So giving him to crocodiles, giving him to sharks and whales, or giving him to hawks and eagles and vultures, very dangerous birds which could peck on and rip his flesh, or giving him to hyenas and dangerous predators. Carnivores who can, you know, or bear which can, you know, rip someone and start eating while being alive. So Prahlad Maharaj was tortured with all of that. When that also failed, they came back to Hiranyakashipu and said, now that is also not working. Now what to do? Hiranyakashipu said, we have one more way. Parvata akramanaihi. Parvata means mountains. It could also mean mountain-like stones. So again, plural has been used. So demons used to lift up big heavy rocks and akramanaihi, throw it on his head. They would take it up and throw it on Prahlad's head. Can you imagine how much Prahlad could have felt? How much he would feel that people whom I am learning under, the teachers and the father from whom I am born, all of them are repeatedly trying only to murder me. There's no one who hates me as much as them. And the one who's protecting me through all of this, there is no one who loves me as much as him. It is only Vishnu who loves me, really, truly loves me. He's protecting me even when my father and my family are trying to kill me. How much love Prahlad Maharaj would have for the Supreme Lord. But even when there was Parvata Akramana, even when there were stones and mountains thrown on the head of Prahlad Maharaj, not a scratch not a scratch was caused to the body of Prahlad Maharaj. At that time, na sashaka yada hantum apapam asurasutam chintam dhirgatamam praptas tat kartum na abhipadhyata. At that time, our king Hiranyakashipu, he became very, very anxious. He became very fearful. All steps are taken. Now, how do I kill him? Dirgatamam, chintam dirgatamam praptas. I am having this anxiety since a long time. Can you imagine? He has got boons from Brahmaji that he will not die. And look how much anxiety is there in someone who is Krishna Bahirmukh, someone who is facing away from the Supreme Lord, and someone who is facing towards the Supreme Lord, Prahlad Maharaj. He has no benediction from anyone. Still, look how peaceful and how fearless Prahlad Maharaj is. Apapam asurasutam. So, apapam. To that personality who had not committed a single pap, Prahlad Maharaj. Asurasutam. Shukdev Goswami is speaking with a lot of pain in his heart. That he was an asurasuta. He was the son of an asura. Although he was apapam, this is 44, although he was sinless, still that asura was trying. And when he was failing, hantum, to kill, when he was not successful in killing him, then chintam dirghatamam praptas. Then he got chinta for a long time, exhausted. His senses are becoming exhausted now, very stressful. You know, I have done so much. I am not able to kill him. What is going wrong? Where am I going wrong? 45. Esha me bahu asadhu uktah. Vadha upayascha nirmitaha. Taitaihi drohai asad dharmaihi muktah svenaiva tejasa. Hiranyakashipu is thinking now. Now suddenly Hiranyakashipu has become very introspective. He is saying, Esha bahu asadhu uktah. To him, to this Prahlad, bahu, many, many times, asadhu ukta, I have spoken improperly. Asadhu ukta. Ukta means ukti, words. I have not spoken properly to him. Many, many times, bahu, which means many times, asadhu ukta, I have spoken many, many times in a very ill way. Hiranyakashipu used to literally use swear words at Prahlad, on his own son, who is such a Mahabhagavat Vaishnava. And not just that, vadha upayaha cha nirmitaha. Nirmita, I have created, I have discovered, I have invented ways, upaya, many, many upaya, many, many, again, bahuvachan has been used. Many, many newer ways I have created and discovered and invented, nirmita, I have created, nirman. For what? Vadha upaya, for the purpose of killing and murdering my son. I have spoken improperly to him and I have tried many ways to kill him. Still, muktaha, svenaiva tejasa, by his own tejas shakti, by his own effulgence, somehow he is not dying. Muktaha, he is free from all of this. And now my fear is, what is his fear? Look at what fear he is having. His fear is, Hiranyakashipu is thinking, my son is such that he's not fighting. When we are all attacking, he's not fighting. He's not running away. You know, it's not that he's trying to fight back. Hiranyakashipu is sitting and peacefully thinking all of this. When I am attacking my son, not once has he tried to punch back. Two, not once he has even tried to protect himself. So he's not fighting. These are the words of Hiranyakashipu. You will see next verse in 46 it will come. He is not fighting. He is not protecting himself. And when we try to punch, okay, he's not fighting, he's not protecting. He's not even running away to escape. And he's not even hiding so that they don't find him. He's just untouched. Svenaiva tejasa muktaha. He seems to be completely free by some power, by his own energy, by his own effulgence, by his own faith. Nothing is touching him. Now my fear is, Hiranyakashipu is thinking, my fear is, what if he holds all of this against me? And in the future, when I get weak, he gets, you know, now he's a child. He's only 5 years old. But all of these impressions will be there in his consciousness. And as he grows up and as he becomes filled with youth, I will become old. And all of this grudge, all of this intensity, he can use it against me. He can use it against me and he can kill me. But I don't know if it will happen, but I think it can happen. He's thinking. He can come and kill me. And if he doesn't kill me, maybe these reactions will somehow come. At that time, he's thinking, but reactions are coming because of demigods, but demigods are under my control. Demigods are fearing me. And I am fearing my son. My son is not fearing me. What is this going on? What is going on? So all of these things are there. Hiranyakashipu is sitting and thinking. He's having a headache. Hiranyakashipu has been called in the seventh canto as Mastaka Jwaraha, as the fever for the head, which means headache. He was a Mastaka Jwaraha. He was, in fact, headache for the whole world. And now that Hiranyakashipu, who is the headache for the whole world, is actually having a headache because of his son. So in 46, he's saying, Vartamanaha avidure vai bala api ajadadhir ayam na vismaranti me anaryam shuna shepa iva prabhu. So Vartamana, now he's in the present state, he's a little child. So therefore he's tolerating. But it's possible in the future he may retaliate. And interestingly, Vartamana could also mean in a tender state where the body, little something can happen and blood can come. You know, children are very sensitive. As we grow, our skin becomes a little more rough and it can take a little more heat. It can take a little more cold and we may have a cut and then still we may have some, ability to tolerate the pain. But children, they start crying. So he's saying Vartamana api, although he's a child and his body is very sensitive, still nothing is working. Or another meaning, he's a child, now he's keeping quiet, maybe in the future he will attack. The next word used is avidure. Dura means far away. Vidura means to run away in such a way that you will never return or to hide. And a means no. So he's saying he's neither running away, nor is he hiding, nor is he escaping. Nothing is happening. And bala api, he's just a child. Still, ajadadhi ayam. Jadadhi, ajadadhi. Jada means either lazy or fearful. And dhi means intellect. He's having ajadadhi. Two meanings to that. Ajadadhi means he's not at all lazy in his performance of remembrance of Vishnu, or he's not at all fearful of all my attacks. And my fear is na vismaranti. He will not forget what I have spoken to him and what I have done to him. He has become like shunaha shepa, which means the tail of a dog. One Sanskrit poet, he, of course, poets, jahana poche ravi vaha poche kavi, you know, they say that where the sun doesn't reach, the poets will reach there also, which means they have their own srishti, they have their own imagination. So one Sanskrit poet, he writes that even if you take the tail of a dog and massage it nicely with, you know, fragrant oil, and nicely you massage with fragrant oil and you put it in a hollow stick for 100 years. Still, when you take the stick out, expecting that the tail of a dog should be straight, when you take it off, it will be crooked back again. It will be curved back again. So Hiranyakashipu is such a demon. He is comparing Prahlad Maharaj's bhakti to the Supreme Lord like the tail of a dog. He is saying, I am trying to give him so much comfort in my palace by being nice to him. And at the same time, on the other side, I am torturing him also. But still, like the crooked end of the tail of a dog, my son has become beyond repair. There is no way out. So what to do now? What do I do to him? What do I do? This shows us we all should perform bhakti to Krishna like this, like the tail of a dog. Just like the tail of a dog doesn't change its shape, even when it's massaged, even if the dog is struggling with disease, the tail still remains crooked. It never becomes straight. So we should be like that. Come what may. Griheva banete take ha gauranga bole dake. Narotama mage tara sanga. Narottam Das Thakur says, someone who's chanting at home and chanting outside also. And sukhe dukhe bhule nako, vadane hari naam bolo re. Bhakti Vinod Thakur says, whether in happiness or distress, someone who's constantly chanting the holy name and not forgetting Krishna, in Hiranyakashipu's words, like the crooked end, the tail of a dog, this is how our bhakti should be. whether sampatti or vipatti, we should perform bhakti. So here Hiranyakashipu is saying in the next verse in 47, he is saying, aprameya anubhavoyam. This person has aprameya shakti, unlimited shakti. Somehow there is something there in him. He is like a bulb, but the bulb is always lit because there is some supply to this bulb. Somewhere he is getting his strength from where I am not getting my strength. I am not like this. Something is wrong. And akutaschit bhayo amaraha. This person has no fear absolutely. And he is amara, he seems to be immortal. Noonam, I feel definitely indeed etat virodhena, because I have done virodh, because I have attacked him and spoken like this. Mrityu me bhavita, he will definitely become my death in the future. And when he's saying this, he looks at Prahlad and he says, Nava, or maybe he will not. Because Prahlad Maharaj's face has this smile and innocence of devotion, almost telling his father that even if you try to kill me, I will not kill you. In the Bhagavatam, there is a very beautiful verse in the first canto, glorifying the glories of the devotees. Tiraskrita vipralabdha shapta kshipta hata api nasya tat pratikurvanti tad bhaktaha prabhavopihi. How are the devotees? Tiraskrita, even when they're criticized. Vipralabdha, even when they're cheated. Shapta, even when they're cursed, like Parikshit Maharaj was cursed. You see, tiraskrita, like Prahlad Maharaj is criticized, or Haridas Thakur is criticized. Vipralabdha, whether devotees are cheated, like the Pandavas were cheated. Tiraskrita, vipralabdha, shapta, even when they are cursed. Or kshipta, when they are ignored. Hata api, even on the brink of death, like Prahlad Maharaj, like Jada Bharat, even when they are about to be killed. Nasyatat pratikurvanti, they don't think of retaliation. Tad bhaktaha prabhavopihi. The Bhagavatam describes this is the power of the devotees of the Lord. They have unflinching faith and dependence that Krishna will protect me. I don't have to worry. Medicines may fail, doctors may fail, my family may fail, but the Lord, the will of my Lord will never fail. If he wants to put me in another body, I will go there. If he wants to protect me, I will be there. Whatever my Lord wants, that is what I want to do. This is what Bhaktivinoda Thakur has also sung in the Manasa Deho Geho Jo Kichhu Mor Arpilu Tuva Pade Nanda Kishore song. He says, Maro bi rakho bi jo ichha tuhar nitya dasa prati tuva adhikar. My Lord, whatever is mine, I give it to you. Manasa Deha Geha, my family, my home, my body, my mind, Jo Kichhu Mor, whatever I call mine, Arpilu Tuva Pade Nanda Kishore. Hey Nanda Kishore, hey son of Nanda Maharaj, I give it to you. And Marobi, in return, you can kill me. Rakhubi, you can protect me. Jo Ichha Tuhar, whatever is your desire. Nitya Dasa Prati Tuva Adhikar, you have complete Adhikar toward your eternal servant. You can do whatever you want. Ashlisheva Padaratam Pinashtuma Madarshanan Marmahatam Karotuva Yatha Tathava Vidadhatu Lampato Mat Prana Natastusa Evanapara. My Lord, you can embrace me, or you can disappear and not appear before me. Or when I fall at your feet, you can crush me to death. Or in front of me, you can go with another gopi. Radharani is saying, but Krishna, I have decided you are the Lord of my life. Mahaprabhu is speaking this in the mood of Radharani. Chauni patitvam athava ekam akinchanatvam nityam dadasi bahumanam athapamanam vaikunthavasam athava narake nivasam ha vasudeva mamanasti gatistvadanya. One Sri Vaishnav Sampradaya Acharya has written that, my Lord, you have two options. Kshauni patitvam athava ekam akinchanatvam. You can make me the king or you can make me the pauper. Nityam dadasi bahumanam atha apamanam. You can give me lot of praise or lot of criticism. Vaikunthavasam athava narake nivasam. You can put me to Vaikuntha, you can throw me down to hell. You have these two options. But I have lovingly accepted only one option. What is that? In your will is my will. Ha Vasudeva, mama na asti gatistvadanya. Apart from you, I have no other destination. Tavai vasmi na jivami twayavina iti vidnyaya devi tvam nayamam charanantikam. Even Raghunath Das Goswami Pad has written the same for Radharani. That, O Radharani, I have decided, whether you accept me or no, I have accepted your lotus feet and I am not going to change. I am going to be like completely stuck to your lotus feet. You please accept me. You can either accept me or reject me, but I have no other master to go to apart from you. So you can see here Prahlad Maharaj's devotion. And even Hiranyakashipu is appreciating and he is saying, akutaschit bhayo maraha. He has become such an amara, he has no bhaya, absolutely. And nunam etat virodhena, because of this virod that I have done, mrityu me bhavita, he will definitely become the cause of my death. Nava, or maybe he will not. Maybe he will not be the cause of my death. Thinking like this, in text 48 of the same chapter, iti tat chintaya kinchit, thinking with chinta, with so much anxiety, what had happened to Hiranyakashipu? Mlana shriyam adho mukham. Mlana shriyam means effulgence. Mlana means completely withered away. He had become thin, and as if all the effulgence had been soaked out, as if somebody put a vacuum cleaner and cleaned and vacuumed out all of his effulgence. So mlana shriya, he had become completely dull. And adho mukham, he was looking down. You can imagine, he may have his hand on his face, completely disappointed that this boy has become such a headache. At that time, what happened? Shanda and Amarka, the two teachers of Prahlad, they came. And they came and they started speaking to Hiranyakashipu. They said, what happened? You know, why are you like this? Don't you remember who you are? Don't you remember? Jitam tvaya ekena jagatrayam bhruvo vijrimbana trasta samasta dhishnyapam. Don't you know who you are? This is text 49. Jitam tvaya, you have won over ekena, just by yourself, without your army, single-handedly tvaya ekena jitam. You single-handedly have won over what? Jagatrayam, the three worlds, upper, middle and lower. And bhruvor vijrimban, just by the movement of your eyebrow, trasta samasta dhishnyapam, all the worlds with their lokapal, the dhikpal, the demigods, the controllers, trasta, they're all shaking and trembling. Why are you worrying? You are the Lord for the whole world. Jitam tvaya ekena jagatrayam bhruvo vijrimbana trasta samasta dhishnyapam. All the worlds and the controllers are trembling just by the angry movement of your eyebrow, and you are so powerful. Why are you worrying? So then Hiranyakashipu says, why should I not worry? Look at how much pain I have in my life. The biggest enemy I have is my son. He is born biologically as my son. Is that not a sad thing? My own son is worshipping my enemy. That enemy of mine who killed my brother, whom I am trying to find and kill, my son in front of me, he is worshipping my enemy. And even when we try so hard to distract him by kind words, by affection, by torturing him, by fear induced, he's not moving out of his opinion. What is happening? Why shouldn't I not be sad? We tried so much. He's not dying. So to that, Shanda and Amarka, they smile. Na tasya chintyam. Don't worry about him. Why should I not worry about him? Na vai shishunam guna dosha yorpadam. He's a shishu, he's a child. And the opinion of children, they will change with time. A child, you know, a kid in his childhood will say, when I grow up, what do you want to become? I will become brahmachari. Then parents will say, okay, when you grow up, we will see, okay? This is what that means. With time, the opinion of kids will change, because in their innocence, they say, but when they grow up, They have influence with their peer and the society and the modes of material nature and the food that they eat, the society that they live in. Everything has its influence. So then the kid will say, I want to become brahmachari. And then as he grows up, then, you know, he will be the first person to get married. And then everyone will say, oh, I thought you wanted to be brahmachari. He'll say, yeah, I thought, but then I changed my plan. Right? So kids will say so many things. In the childhood, you ask them, what do you want to become? Oh, I want to become pilot. What do you want to become? Oh, I want to become cricketer. What do you want to become? Oh, I want to become doctor. And when they grow up, then they all become engineers. So they will say so many things in their childhood. So here, that logic has been used by Shanda and Amarka. Na vai shishunam kuna dosha yorpadam. Don't take the good qualities and bad qualities of kids very seriously. They may chant in the childhood. Parents will become very proud, or my child is chanting. But then when they grow up, that 16 rounds will become 5 rounds and 4 rounds and then no round. Parents will have to say so much and the children will not chant also. So this has been seen in this world. He says, similarly, his opinions will change. You don't worry. And text 50, imam tu pashaihi varunasya bhadva. Don't worry, we will bind him till then. How we will bind? With what rope? Imam tu, to this Prahlad, paashaihi badva. We will bind him with paash, with rope. What kind of rope? Varunasya paash. Now, the rope of Varuna is very famous. It's something that cannot be broken. So, because Varuna was under Hiranyakashipu, Shanda and Amarkar saying, we will bind Prahlad with the ropes of Varun. Imam tu paashai varunasya badva nidehi bhito na palayate yatha. Why? So that he doesn't run away. Na palayate. So that he doesn't go anywhere and run away, we will protect him. We will nidehi bhito na palayate yatha. Now, it's interesting. Yatha. Whatever we teach him is what he will speak. Don't worry. We will not let him associate with anyone. We will bind him not with ropes but with Varuna's paash. He will not be able to escape and run away. And what we teach him is what he will learn. Because man is known by the company he keeps. So you don't have to worry. Buddhischa pumso vayasarya sevaya yavat gurur bhargava agamishyati. His buddhi will change with time. And we, whatever we feed is what he will understand. And at the same time, vayasa, with age, everything will be okay. And to add more purification, arya sevaya. Our guru, yavad guru, who guru? Bhargava. In the Bhrigu Vamsha is Shukracharya. So he's called Bhargava. So yavad guru or Bhargava agamishyati. Till our guru comes, we will take care. And when our guru comes, arya sevaya, we will put Prahlad as the personal servant to Shukracharya. So by age, by the Varun Pash, by our teaching, the isolation from society, and then when Bhargava, our Gurudev, Shukracharya comes, then Arya Sevaya, by serving the Guru, all good qualities will come. Nothing to worry. So they spoke like this and Hiranyakashipu became very pacified. Hiranyakashipu then said, okay, I feel better now that there is hope for my son and y'all will take care. So what you will do now? Tell me. So they said, you don't worry. First, you take your hand out of your head. Understand who you are. Take a deep breath. Look at you, what you have done to yourself. Understand you're Hiranyakashipu. You're the ruler of the whole world. So you don't worry. Give us time. Give him time. Everything will be okay. Hiranyakashipu said, okay, wonderful. What do you plan to teach him now? They said, we will teach him dharma, artha, kama, moksha. Hiranyakashipu said, no. No teaching him moksha. Just teach him dharma, artha and kama. This is why we see the word in text 52, dharma artha cha kamam cha. There is no moksha there. Text 52. So Shanda and Amarka say, we will teach him dharma artha kama moksha. Because at the moment, Prahlad Maharaj is on the pancham purushartha, which is prema bhakti. So they said, we will get him down to the four. Dharma artha kama and moksha. Hiranyakashipu said, no moksha. Don't speak about liberation. Then he will go to bhakti. Just teach him dharma, artha and kama. That's all. No mukti shiksha. So Guru said, okay, we will teach him only these things. And at the same time, we will teach him very nicely. We will not slap him. We will not kick him. We will not attack him. With love, we will try. Is that okay? Hiranyakashipu said, okay. Now, text 53. Yatha tri vargam guru bihi. Now, the guru bihi, again, plural has been used. So many gurus were appointed. Three vargam. They taught him dharma, artha and kama. Three means three. Vargam means category. So they taught him three processes or categories. Dharma, artha and kama. Atmane to Prahlad. Upashikshitam. They sat close to him. Upa means closer and shikshitam means to teach. So they sat close to Prahlad Maharaj. And they lovingly taught him. You see, Bhagavatam reveals himself by the words. So not just shiksha. The word is upashikshitam. So he was taught upa. Upa means closely. Like upavas, so upayog, the words in Sanskrit have come like that. So upa means closer and shikshitam means to teach. So they were not teaching, keeping him on a bench and teaching. They were giving one-to-one teaching. So you have to think, Prahlad is sitting next to Shanda and Amarka and very lovingly they are moving their hand on Prahlad. He said, don't worry, whatever has happened in the past, forget it. It's a new page on the book of life. We are there to teach you in this way, yatha. Tri Vargam Guru Bhi. The Guru taught these three categories. Atmane to Prahlad Maharaj, who was on the level of Atma. Upashikshitam. Repeatedly taught. But what happened to Prahlad? Na sadhu mene tat shiksham. That shiksha, na sadhu mene. He did not consider it to be first class. Why? Dvandva aram upavarnitam. Because upavarnitam, what were they describing? Dvandva. They were describing duality. They were describing friends and enemies, profit and loss. They were describing favorable, unfavorable, friend, enemy, profit, loss, attack, protect. Prahlad Maharaj was thinking, what is this attack and protect? We don't attack anyone. We don't get protected by anyone. It's Krishna who does it, does everything. And we have no enemies. Everyone is our friend. Vasudha eva kutumbakam. Krishna lives in their heart. How can they be enemies? So although Atmane upashikshitam, they taught with so much affection. Na sadhu mene tat shiksham. Prahlad Maharaj did not consider that to be first class because dvandva arama upavarnitam. Because it was describing dvandva. Dvandva means two, duality. But Prahlad Maharaj was in one, absolute truth. Only Krishna. Sarvam krishnamayam jagat. Sarva bhuteshu yaha pashyet bhagavan bhavam atmanaha bhutani bhagavatyatmani esha bhagavatottama. Prahlad Maharaj was only seeing the Supreme Lord in everything and everyone. So when they were teaching, what happened? Text 54. One day, there is a change in plot now. Yada acharya parabritto griha medhiya karmasu. One time, paravrittaha, they became busy. In what? Griha medhiya karmasu. The teachers one day became very busy in household activity. Griha medhiya karmasu. Karmasu means in the activities. Many activities, household activities. Yada, one day. Sanskrit da means time. So yada means that time when acharya, the teachers, paravrittaha, griha medhiya karmasu, when they became busy one fine day, at that time, kritakshanaihi, at that very moment, taking advantage of that situation, what happened? Vayasyaihi balakaihi tatra sa upahutaha. Vayasyaihi, vayasyaihi means samavayasa, those of the same age, balakaihi, all the friends of Prahlad who were of the same age, tatra, that point, kritakshanaihi, taking advantage of that moment, what did they do? Sa Prahlad upahutaha. They called Prahlad. It's interesting. There is bhed here. Some places it says that Prahlad called them. Like here it is described. He would call them saha. And in some places it is described that they would call him. So at the moment when the teachers left, Prahlad would call friends, thinking that now is the time I should speak to them. Or, Athava, they were calling Prahlad. Now, there is our teachers have taught us from both perspectives. If Prahlad is calling them, why would Prahlad call them? Prahlad had so much compassion in his heart that my friends, they are also born in demoniac family. Their parents are also demons. And they're eating demoniac food. There is no prasad. They have no association. Nobody's telling them. Nobody's preaching to them about Kanti Mala, Tilak and devotion and chanting the holy name. God knows next up for all the sins that they perform in this life, for all the bad things that they hear and see and eat and think, what kind of animal life they will get next life. So out of compassion, Prahlad Maharaj used to think, all the brainwashing that my teachers have done right now, let me clear all of that and actually wash their brain with devotion in this time that I have. So out of compassion, he would speak and call them. And on the other hand, some also say that Prahlad used to just chant. And they, the friends, used to be so attracted by his beauty and by his effulgence and the power that was there, the empowerment that was there in Prahlad Maharaj, that instead of playing, they would get attracted to Prahlad Maharaj and they would say, we heard about all the atrocities that they performed to you. What is it that protects you? What is that strength in you? We want to know more about it. We heard that they threw you from the top of the mountain. We heard that they pushed you in fire. We heard that they submerged you in water. We heard that they poisoned you even. And you're still alive. There is something in you. Can you tell us more about what happened? So friends were either attracted by his beauty, his effulgence, his stage, his devotion, and how much he had gone through without any complaint. So both have been described. So apahutaha, saha apahutaha, he would call them or they would be called by him either way. And at that time, look at 55. Text 55 describes how a preacher should preach. Very, very beautiful lesson for all of us. How should the preacher, when someone comes to us or we go to someone, how should we speak? Text 55 speaks about preaching. Atha, at that time, tan. Tan is the plural usage for friends. Saha tau te tam tau tan. Third person plural has been used. Atha tan to all the friends, what did Prahlad do? Shlakshnaya vacha. His speech was with lot of sweetness. Lot of sweetness. And pratyahuya mahabuddha. He would speak to them, addressing them. He would call them by name with lot of affection. And the mahabuddha, the word used is he who had lot of intelligence. He knew how to speak to each boy. He knew what background the boy came from, what the characteristics of the father was. And he would instruct them accordingly. So he had very intelligent way of connecting with each one of them individually. He would address them personally and include them affectionately. And shlakshnaya vacha, the words used to be very, very sweet and pleasing. And as he spoke, vidvams, as he spoke, he was speaking with a lot of conviction. Tat nishtham, with a lot of conviction on the path. At the same time, he was preaching vidvams in a very scholarly way, which was convincing them. But what was the intention behind that preaching? Kripaya. It was just so that they get help. And throughout Prahasan, he had a smile on his face. He was not preaching with aggression and envy, and it was not like a hate speech. It was love speech. Prahasan, he used to smile and laugh and talk to them very kindly. In this way, Prahlad Maharaj has spoken to them. And here it has been described that Prahlad Maharaj used to think that now is the time I can speak to all of them and take care of them. So the teachings of Prahlad Maharaj, the instructions, the conversations that Prahlad Maharaj has, it spans over two chapters, chapter 6 and 7. So that is beyond the scope today. So we can have it on some other day. But I will go straight to text 1 of chapter 8. Canto 7, chapter 8, text 1. We will see now what is happening. Sri Narada Uvacha, Narad Muni is speaking. Atha daitya sutaha sarve shrutva tad anuvarnitam jagrahu niravadyatvan naiva guru anushikshitam. Beautiful. What was the effect of that preaching? Two chapters of preaching, what happened? Narad Muni is saying, Atha, at that time, daitya sutaha, all those children who were children of the demons, sarve, everyone, not one person turned away, everyone, shrutva, having heard what Prahlad Maharaj was teaching, tad anuvarnitam. They practiced it in their real life and they also started speaking to each other. So varnanam means to speak or to murmur or to chant, to describe. Anu means repeatedly, in a very favorable way, under Prahlad Maharaj's guidance. Shrutva, hearing that, tad anu varnitam. They were following it, they were practicing it, talking to each other, even maybe chanting japa or singing or even giving discourses to each other. And they did this to such an extent that naiva guru anushikshitam. Absolutely, they rejected what their guru taught them. The Shanda and Amarka. And the word naiva, na eva, absolutely. So the word exclusive rejection is shown by the word naiva. Na eva, absolutely no. Guru anushikshitam. Whatever guru repeatedly taught, anushikshitam. Anu means repeatedly, shikshitam means to teach. Whatever the guru repeatedly taught, that was completely kicked out by Prahlad Maharaj's teaching. So the teachers taught and Prahlad Maharaj took the opportune moment, preached to the friends, and the friends rejected all of their teaching and just accepted what Prahlad Maharaj told them. And this we could understand the next day. So by the word sarve, we could understand that maybe they took it up to such an extent. Next day, they may have even come to school with tilak and kanti mala and chanting bead bag also. You never know. Or they may be doing kirtan while coming to school. So all of that is to be understood. At that time, atha acharya sutas tesham buddhim ekant samsthitam alakshya bhitas torito rajnyah avedayat yatha. Now look, the teachers have got scared. Now the teachers have got scared. What has happened? Atha, at that time, acharya suta. This refers to the teachers, Shanda and Amarka, who were the sons of Shukracharya. Atha acharya sutas tesham, what did they do? Ekant samsthitam buddhim. They understood that all the students, Tesham, Bahuvachan, All the students had become Krishna conscious. Ekanta samsthitam. Samsthitam means situated. Samyak rupena sthita. Completely situated. Buddhim. Their intellect. In their intellect, there was complete nishtha of who? Ekanta. Now, eka anta. Eka means one and anta means end. Who remains at the end of this whole creation? It is Hari alone. Krishna alone is in the beginning of the creation, during the whole process of maintenance, and even after destruction. So, eka anta, one truth which remains at the end of everything, that is Hari. So, buddhim ekanta samsthitam, this is second text of the 8th chapter of the 7th canto. Acharya Sutas, when the sons of Shukracharya, Shanda and Amarka, they saw this, buddhim ekanta samsthitam, they understood that along with Prahlad, all the kids, they have in their mati completely given to Eka Anta, Hari, who remains at the end. And Alakshya, seeing this, Bhita, they became very scared. Because now they have promised Hiranyakashipu, don't worry, no, why are you worrying? You should realize who you are. But now they failed. So now they were fearing that they will lose their job as teachers. They may even lose their life for speaking false, that I will take care, we will take care, we will bind him with the Varun Pash, we will teach him, we will just give time, we will put him at the service of Shukracharya, what not. They gave all of these things, but they saw now the Vaishnavism is spreading. It was not just Prahlad, they promised Hiranyakashipu they will make Prahlad all right, but now Prahlad is making many more Prahlads. Therefore, you know, when you see that there is influence of friends, even till this very day, many times people say, you know, maybe he has a friend like Prahlad. You know, they say it like that. That when there is an influence, friendly influence on someone, they say, oh, maybe he has a friend like Prahlad. So that is how Prahlad Maharaj was. His preaching was so powerful because of his bhajan, because of his intensity. So looking at this bhitaha, they became very scared. Now maybe the king will kick us out of service, or he may even do that with us, what he did with his own son. If he can do it to Prahlad, he can definitely do it to us. And Twarita, very quickly, they ran to the king and Avedayat. They actually spoke. How did they speak? Yatha. The word yatha means whatever happened, they spoke as it is. On this day, this happened. He did this. We tried this. But, you know, by then when we went there, he spoke like this. The next day we saw this boy also came. So the word yatha means they just spoke and explained everything that happened. Now, as they are speaking, look at Hiranyakashipu. Kopa vesha chalad gatraha putram hantum mano dadhe kshitva parushaya vacha prahladam atatat arhanam. Kopa avesha. He had so much kopa avesh. As Hiranyakashipu was listening, there was so much anger that rose in his body. That chalat gatra, gatra means body, and chalat, it started moving. So you can imagine, as they are speaking, Hiranyakashipu's eyebrows are moving, his hands are moving, his lips are quivering, and he's biting with anger, and his hands and legs are getting restless. He's probably hitting the side of the chair in anger. All of this is to be understood. Ko pavesha chalat gatra, his hands were moving. And putra hantum manodadhe, he gave his mind to that activity, that now my son must be killed. Putram hantum. Hantum means to kill, and putra means son. Manodadhe, he almost gave his mind to that thought, or he fixed his mind on this principle that I must kill my son. Well, why is this said here, putram hantum manodadhe? Because till now, Hiranyakashipu had not tried killing his son. He employed others to kill Prahlad. Because he was thinking, you know, people may criticize that, what kind of a father are you? You are trying to kill your own son. So he employed others so that there is no blemish on his character. But here the word, it's not Prahlad, it is putram. For the first time, Hiranyakashipu thought, now it is enough. He will die, and he will die through my hands. Till now, others were employed. It was Prahladam Hantum Manodadhe. But here, it is Putram Hantum Manodadhe. I will kill my own son. And saying this, what did he do? Kshiptva Parushaya Vacha. Very, very harsh words, with very dangerous, dirty words. Kshiptva, he threw Prahlad off his lap. And Prahlad Maharaj actually deserves so much respect. He's on our altars. All of our temples, we see Prahlad Maharaj with Narsingadev on the picture, on the DT form. He deserves so much. Like devotees pray to Prahlad Maharaj. We always sing Jaya Prahlad Narsingha. So he deserves respect and worship. But Kshiptva Parushaya Vacha Prahladam Atad Arhanam. What did he do? He gave Prahlad something that Prahlad did not deserve. That is, threw him off the lap and spat harsh words at him. And not just that. Ahekshamana papena tirashchinena chakshusha prashraya vanatam dantam baddhanjalim avasthitam sarpah padahata iva shvasan prakriti daruna. Nice comparison has been given between Prahlad and Hiranyakashipu here. So, Ahekshamana papena, which means Tirashchinena Chakshusha. He had eyes which were very red, and Ahekshamana papena. He was so sinful, and his eyes were spitting anger. And instead of seeing Prahlad straight, he was looking at Prahlad from a side long distance. So you can imagine if someone is very angry and they have to give the side glance. Either you can give side long glance in affection, like Radharani gives for Krishna, or in anger. Instead of looking straight, he would, he was looking at Prahlad Maharaj with angry side glances. So, Ahekshamana papena tirashchinena chakshusha. What else happened after that? As he's glancing at Prahlad Maharaj is avanatam dantam. Prashrayavanatam dantam. Prahlad Maharaj is avanat. Avanat means completely bowed down. As he threw Prahlad Maharaj to the floor, Prahlad Maharaj is offering obeisances, holding the feet of his father. And dantam. Dantam means complete sense control. So, what specifically here it means is control over tongue. Hiranyakashipu was chastising Prahlad Maharaj. He was shouting at Prahlad Maharaj. He was glancing like this. And what was Prahlad Maharaj doing? Offering obeisances. And then he stood up, he had a smile, complete control. He's, shouting at Prahlad Maharaj. Hiranyakashipu shouting on the top of his voice. And many, many dirty words, harsh words have been used, swear words have been used. Vachanam shilam akhyati. A person's character can be seen by what kind of quality of words his tongue are vibrating. So Hiranyakashipu was shouting and yelling. And what was Prahlad Maharaj doing? Prashraya avanatam dantam. He was offering obeisances and at the same time, dantam, completely, his tongue was complete control. So, this is how we recognize a devotee. When you criticize him and he criticizes us back, that is not wonderful example. But when someone criticizes us and we keep quiet, we have passed the test. We have passed the test. In fact, not as an example, but one freedom fighter in India used to say that, in fact, one married couple came to him and said, it was Mahatma Gandhi. So one married couple came to Mahatma Gandhi and said, we have a lot of fight between us. And then both keep shouting. So what to do? And Mahatma Gandhi at that time said, when one is angry, the other feels like giving back. At that time, they should fill up their mouth with water. And not spit it out and not gulp it in, which means when the mouth is filled with water, you can't open to speak, so which means one should keep quiet. So there is a joke that sometimes people say that when in married life, sometimes the husband shouts and the wife keeps quiet, and sometime after a few years, the wife shouts and the husband keeps quiet. And after a few more years, husband and wife shout, and the whole world listens. this is the nature of Kali Yuga. One is shouting, other is listening. Then this person is shouting, this person is listening. But when both shout, the whole world listens. So this is the nature of fights. But when Hiranyakashipu was shouting and fighting, Prahlad was not giving anything. He was complete dantam, complete control over his mind. Vacho vegam, manasa krodha vegam. All of them were there in Prahlad Maharaj and all of them were absent in Hiranyakashipu. So this is the shubha shubhicha that are fighting. So his tongue is controlled, mind is controlled, and anger, there is no anger. And not just that, how is he standing? बद्धांजलिम अवस्थितम. He stands up now. Prahlad Maharaj stands up looking at his father who's so angry. He's smiling and he has folded. Baddhanjali means folded palms. Avasthitam. He's standing with folded palms. And this is making Hiranyakashipu more angry than before. You know, whatever nonsense you had to do, you're doing, and now you're standing with folded palms in front of me. What kind of hypocrisy is this? I told you, listen to your teachers. Teachers are teaching you. You are still not changing. That is one thing. That was one headache. Now this headache is spreading. You are also preaching. And now when I am shouting at you, you are standing with folded palms. I am feeling irritated by you, said Hiranyakashipu. How much? Sarpaha padahato eva. Just like a snake, you know, by nature it is very angry. Prakriti, you see, shvasan prakriti daruna. By nature the snake is very angry. Now when pada, hata, when feet, we touch the snake by the feet, what happens? The sarpa starts getting even more angrier. The snake by nature has poison. But now accidentally when you keep your feet on the snake, now finish, the snake will, you know, have its hood up and ready to fight. So that example has been given here. That Hiranyakashipu is like a snake and Prahlad Maharaj is standing with folded palms. What is there to be angry in that? But Hiranyakashipu's venom is only increasing. In Sanskrit, there is an ukti, there is a subhashita. Upadesho hi murkhanam prakopaya nashantaye payapana bhujanganam kevalam vishavardhanam. It's a very natural phenomenon from nature. The subhashita has been formed. That when you give advice or you give good words to a fool, upadesho hi murkhanam, it doesn't pacify them. Prakopaya na shantaya. Na shantaya. It doesn't pacify them, but prakopa. It makes them more angrier than before. And the example is payaha pana bhujanganam kevalam vishavardhanam. If you give milk and nice leaves, fresh leaves to a snake to eat as goodwill, what happens? Kevalam vishavardhanam. That will only increase its poison. So here that example has been given. Shukadev Goswami and Narad Muni, as they speak, they also add metaphors and examples. So it's really nice. Bhagavatam, we can learn so much from Srimad Bhagavatam. So at this point, Hiranyakashipu is almost hissing like a snake. And look at Shukdev Goswami's humor. He says in text 5 of chapter 8, Shri Hiranyakashipu Uvacha. It could have been Hiranyakashipu Uvacha, but why Shri Hiranyakashipu Uvacha? Why Shri? Because Shri means beautiful. So Shukadeva Goswami is laughing at this point as he's speaking. And he is saying, Hiranyakashipu in his anger looked very beautiful. His eyebrows were moving and he was biting his lips and his hands and legs were trembling. And his golden form had become completely red because of the fire of his anger. So Shukdev Goswami is cutting a sarcastic joke here by saying Shri Hiranyakashipu Uvacha. That Hiranyakashipu who looked very beautiful with all good qualities, he spoke. Now Hiranyakashipu is telling Prahlad Maharaj, He Durvinita Mandatman Kulabhedakara Adhama Sthabdam Mad Shasana Udvrittam Neshe Tu Adya Yamakshayam. Look how many adjectives Hiranyakashipu has given Prahlad Maharaj. He said, Durvinita. Vinita means humility. Durvinita. You have no humility. Mandatman. Foolish. Mandabhagya yukta. You have no fortune in your life. You are born with a golden spoon. You can just inherit my property. Just say yes to what and you will become the king. Now you will not get that kingdom and at the same time you will have the durbhagya of dying in the hands of your own father. What kind of a fool you are. And kula bheda kara. What has been the line of our family? Kula bheda. Kula sampradaya. What our family has been bringing. What tradition. And you are bheda kara. You are walking away from the family tradition. My brother, me, we are all so great. We are all terrorists and you are the only sadhu. Kula bhedakara. You have walked away from our family. And adhama, you are really fallen. Really fallen. I am looking down at you not just because of your age and your height, but even because of your consciousness. I am supposed to sit up because of my high consciousness and look down. Your adham. And stop them. Although you are bowing down to me with your body, You don't bow down to my desires. Stop them. You're standing tall. Your body is bowing down to me, but your mind, you're very arrogant. You're not bending. And mat shasana udvrittam, you're having the power to break my shasana. Now you see, adya, today only, you see what I'm going to do. Adya tu neshya, I'm going to drag you, yamakshayam, to the house of Yamaraj. Do you even know who I am? Now, look, Hiranyakashipu starts speaking. Text 6. Kruddasya yasya kampante trayo lokaha saha ishwaraha tasya me abhitavat mooda shasanam kimbala tyagaha. Kruddasya yasya kampante, just by my anger. By my anger, kridyasya, just by my anger, what happens? Kampante, there is trembling. Lokaha traya, in the three worlds, saha ishwaraha, with their demigods, all of them tremble when I get angry. And here I am in full anger and I'm about to use weapons at you to kill and still look at you. Tasya me abhitavat, you have no fear, absolutely. Mudha, such a fool, you don't know how to behave in front of your father. Shasanam kim bala. Atyagaha, to go beyond my shasan, kimbala, where are you getting your strength from? Who gives you the strength? Now you see, Hiranyakashipu is so angry. He's so angry. And he's so demoniac that he is calling ill names to a Vaishnava. And he's saying, kimbala, what is that strength? You tell me. No, today you tell me, before I send you to Yamraj, you tell me, what is that strength that gives you the ability to atyaga. Atyaga means to go beyond the boundary of mat shasanam. You're going beyond the boundary of my rules and regulations. Kimbala. He could have said Vishnu. Hiranyakashipu could have called out the names of Sri Hari. But because he's so sinful, he has so much aparadha against Vaishnavas, even the name of the Lord is not coming on the tongue. Even the name of the Lord is not coming on the tongue. Kridyasya yasya kampante, by my anger, traya loka saha ishwaraha, the worlds with their demigods, they are all trembling. Tasya me abhitavat, still abhitavat, you have no fear of me, and mudaha, such a fool you are. Mat shasana matyagaha, to go repeatedly beyond the boundary of my shasana, my discipline. Kimbala, tell me, where are you getting your strength from? Who is giving you that strength? Tell me, today you tell me, I am asking you. It's not that Hiranyakashipu was asking some humble inquiry that Prahlad Maharaj, please tell me, where do we all get our strength from? No, he was being very sarcastic. Where is the strength coming from? And at the same time, because he was so sinful, he's saying Kimbala. He cannot even say Hari. He cannot say Govinda. He's not able to say Vishnu. The name of the Lord is not coming, but he's indirectly he's saying. At that time, Prahlad Maharaj, out of so much mercy, he is speaking to Hiranyakashipu. Hiranyakashipu is asking this question, so to that Prahlad Maharaj is answering. Shri Prahlad Uvacha. Now here Shri means beautiful Prahlad with devotional qualities. Shri Prahlad Uvacha. Na kevalam me bhavatascha rajan savai balam balinam cha aparesham pare bare mi sthira jangamaye brahmadayo yena vasham pranita. My dear father, na kevalam me, when you're asking the question, who's giving you the strength? Na kevalam me, not just me, bhavatascha rajan, O king, even you. You should ask the question, where are you also getting your strength from? Not just me, not just you. Sarvai balam balinam chaparesham. All the strong people get the strength from the same place, from where you and I are getting the strength. And not just that, pare, avare, ami, sthira jangamaye. In the upper planetary systems, in the lower planetary systems, and even here, Ami means to point out, even here, sthavara jangama, the moving, non-moving, everybody, and brahmadayo yena vasham pranita, and all the demigods are under whose strength? That same Lord, from whom demigods get strength, upper planetary systems, middle planetary system, lower planetary systems get strength, the moving, non-moving get strength, you get strength, I am also getting strength from the same Lord. Oh, my dear father, since you have asked, let me tell you who he is and how he is. This is text 8 now. Prahlad Maharaj is saying the qualities of the Supreme Lord. Sa Ishwara Kala Urukramasau Oja Saha Sattva Balendriyatma Sa Eva Vishwam Parama Swashakti Bihi Srijati Avati Atti Gunatrayeshaha. Oh, Saha Ishwara. He is the Lord My dear father, he controls everyone and everything. Kala, he is the lord of time also. Yesterday, today, tomorrow, he is the one who moves it. Urukrama, his activities are beyond understanding. He can be Vaman at the same time Urukram. He's smaller than the smallest, larger than the largest. Ojaha, the strength that he has. All the strength, the senses that we have, the power to see, the power to hear. You're asking me, right? The power to speak and I'm speaking. The power to speak and when you're speaking, I'm listening. When I'm speaking, you're listening. Prahlad Maharaj is saying. This ability also. And when you're speaking, I'm understanding and answering. And when I'm speaking, you're understanding and replying. This ability also. Oja. Bala. Indriya. Atma. The strength of the soul. The strength of the body, the strength of these senses, it all comes from that Supreme Lord. Not just that, not just for me and you, oh dear Father, Sa eva vishwam paramaswa shakti bihi. This whole world is made by Him. Our bodies are made by Him, our senses are made by Him, the ability is given by Him, our souls are His. We belong to Him. He is the one who gives strength to the whole world. And not just my Lord Shrijati, He creates, maintains, destroys everything that exists. Every single thing comes from the same strength. So don't please ask me where I am getting the strength from. Just ask me where is the source of all strength. The source of all strength is Shri Hari. When Prahlad Maharaj is saying this, Hiranyakashipu is slapping his thighs and he's saying, such a foolish point, doesn't make any philosophical sense. Why doesn't make any philosophical sense? Look what Hiranyakashipu says. Hiranyakashipu says, he can give you strength because you are his servant. Why will he give me strength? I am his enemy. You know, enemies don't support each other. Friends support each other. So you are feeding him through yajnas and prayer and whatnot. So therefore, he may be giving you strength, just like I give strength to my followers. But I don't give strength to Vishnu. Why will he give me strength? Such a foolish point that Vishnu gives strength to everyone, to me, to you. No, no, we are not on the same point. You are his friend. I am his enemy. And enemies don't help each other. So when he says this, at that time, Prahlad Maharaj tells him, my dear father, this is the first thing you have to give up. You have to give up this asuric mentality. You have to give up this asuric bhav. In text 9, he says, Jayasuram bhava imam tom atmana. Give up. Jayu means give up. Asuram bhava. Give up this mentality that because he killed your brother, he is your enemy. Please give up. Samam mano dhatsvana shanti na santi vidvishaha. Please control your mind and tell yourself, God is not anybody's enemy. If there is an enemy for you, tell yourself that thought that you have an enemy is your enemy. There is no other enemy. We don't have any enemies in this world. You have no enemy, dear father. You have no enemy, absolutely. You have no enemy. Tell yourself this. Vishnu is not your enemy. Nobody is your enemy. Vishnu is not anybody's enemy. We all belong to him and therefore, because everyone belongs to Vishnu, we belong to each other. There's no enemy. Vishnu lives in everyone's heart. He is not your enemy. Give up this thought. There is only one enemy we all have, and that is the uncontrolled mind. If you win over that uncontrolled mind, you have no enemies. And this, Prahlad Maharaj says, Anantasya Mahat Samarhanam. If you, the real worship of Sri Hari is this thought that we have no enemies. Hiranyakashipu says, yeah, this what you have said is correct. I have no enemies. You're saying we don't have any enemies. That's true. I have no enemies because I had enemies. I have won over all directions. I have won over all my enemies. And I have no more enemies right now. You're right. When you said we have no enemies, I have no enemies. That's true. I have no enemies. I had enemies. I have won over all directions. Now I have no any more enemies. What you've said is right. Prahlad Maharaj says at in text 10. No, no, no. That's not what I'm saying, dear father. Dasyun pura shat na vijitya lumpato manyanta eke swajita dishodasha jitatmano nyasya samasya dehinam sadho swamoha prabhava kutapare. My dear father, you may not have enemies outside. I agree. You have won over all directions and you have no enemies. But I want to tell you something. You have six enemies sitting inside. Shat. Shat means six, like Shat Goswami. You have six enemies, mind and five senses. Your eyes are taking you somewhere. Your nose is taking you somewhere. Your desire to eat is taking you somewhere. Your ears are taking you somewhere. Your mind is all taking you. And They are all dasyun. Dasyun means they are all thieves. And they are stealing away your buddhi. You may have won over the 10 directions, dear father. Swa jita disha dashaha. 10 directions. Disha. The 10 directions you have won over. 10 you can win. But these 6 inside you are not able to win. This is what I am saying. The greatest enemy you have is swa moha. The fact that you have no enemies is your enemy. You have 6 enemies sitting inside and they are disturbing and destroying you. As a friend, I am saying this. I am your well-wishing son. You may not have enemies outside, but you have 6 enemies sitting inside and they are stealing away your buddhi, dear father. They are stealing away. Dasyun means enemies. So they are thieves. They are plundering all of your wealth. The wealth of your viveka buddhi, of discrimination. So this is how devotees think, that anarthas are actually sitting inside. We have no enemies outside. So at that time, Hiranyakashipu gets even more angrier. You rascal, till now you were a problem. Then you increased your preaching to your friends. That was a bigger problem. Now when I'm confronting you, you have the audacity to start preaching to me. You have preached to yourself, you're preaching to your friends, and now you preach to your father. You are preaching to your father who stood for thousands of years and you're teaching about controlling the mind and senses. You are going to teach me about controlling the mind. You're going to teach me about austerity. Well, Hiranyakashipu did perform austerity, but it was not tapo divyam. The austerity was great, but the intention was not so good. So now when he got angry, Hiranyakashipu tells Prahlad Maharaj in 11, Vyaktam tvam martu kamosi. Vyaktam. Now you are expressing to me very clearly, tvam martu kamosi, that you really want to die. You're putting yourself so up and you're putting me down. You think I'm so low and you're very advanced? Think when a son starts teaching the father anything in this world, it is not taken so nicely. It's not good for the son and for the father also. But especially now when the son starts teaching the father about things that the father has pride about, then the father will say, you don't teach me these things. You know, I have seen life more than you. So here, Prahlad Maharaj is teaching Hiranyakashipu about sense control and mind control. Mumurshunam hi mandatman nanu syur viklavagiraha. Bhagavatam describes in the same verse. Hiranyakashipu starts telling Prahlad Maharaj that when a person is dying because of pain in the body, he may blabber things which are incoherent. So you are speaking things which are incoherent. I think you are on the verge of death. Let me kill you. Yastvaya manda bhagyokto. You are so manda bhagya. You have no bhagya in your life. Mad anyo jagat ishwara. You are seeing a jagat ishwara apart from me. Now look at this. At text 11, such an interesting point has been asked. Yastvaya manda bhagyokto. Mad anyo jagat ishwara. You have so much pride and so much ill fortune. You are telling me about another ishwara in this world. You are telling me there is someone higher than me. Now I have a question for you. Ko asau yadi sa sarvatra kasmat sthambena drishyate. Tell me, where is that Hari? You are talking about some Jagadishwara. You are preaching to me. Okay. Today let's just talk this out. Let me know. Ko asau, where is he? Where is he? You tell me, where is he? Where is that Vishnu? So when he says ko asau, where is he? At that time, Prahlad Maharaj is saying, Saha Sarvatra Asti. Where is he? Oh, Saha Sarvatra Asti. He is everywhere. So, at that time it is described that Hiranyakashipu bound Prahlad to a pillar. That now I will cut your head. I will cut your head with a sword. I will tie you to a pillar so that you don't run. Because till now, you are protected. But when I pick up the sword, you will run for your life. But so that you don't run, I will tie you to a pillar. And then after tying him to the pillar, he asked him, Kutra, where is Vishnu? So Sarvatra Asti. So Sarvatra Asti. So then at that time, Hiranyakashipu says, Yadi sa Sarvatra Asti, if he is everywhere, Etasmin Sthambe Kasmatna Drishyate Maya. If he is everywhere, then why I am not able to see him in this pillar? Why am I not able to see him in this pillar? So Prahlad Maharaj smiled and he looked at the pillar. He said, Krishna is there in the stumbles. Maya drishyate. I am able to see. He folded palms and he said, Stambhe Maya Drishyate, I can see him in the pillar. So Hiranyakashipu shouted, Maya na Drishyate, I cannot see him. Tell me why I cannot see him. Where is he? Yadi Vishnu sarvatra asti etasmin stambhe kasmat na drishyate maya. If he is everywhere, why I am not able to see him in this pillar? You need devotion, Baba. You need devotion. You cannot see him like that. So at that point, at text 13, Hiranyakashipu. So aham vikattamanasya shiraha kaya dharamite. Now I will take my sword and shiraha kaya dharami. I will separate your head from the body. And gopayet haristvadya. If your hari can protect you today, yaste sharanam ipsitam, you have taken shelter of him. Let me see if he can protect you today. You're talking too much. You're talking about the strength of Vishnu and you're saying stambhe asti. You can see him in the stambha, which I am not able to see. Now I will now separate your head from your body with my sword. And let me see. Adya. Today I will see if your hari can protect you. Gopayet haristvadya yaste sharanam. Ipsitam. You take shelter of that hari. You have taken shelter and you still take today. We'll see. I will consider him the true protector if he can protect you today. And saying this, what did Hiranyakashipu do? Evam duruktair muhurardhayan rusha sutam mahabhagavatam mahasuraha khadgam pragriyot patito varasanat sthambam tadadhi balasa swamushthina. What did he do? Evam duruktaihi, speaking such bad words, muhuhu, again and again, rusha, with so much anger, sutam, how was the son? Mahabhagavatam. He was a great devotee. And how was the father? Mahasura. Look at the comparison. Evam duruktair muhurardhayan rusha, sutam mahabhagavatam mahasura. This combination of demoniac father and great devotee, when they came together, khadgam pragriyot patito varasanat. He got up from his asan. Vara asan. Vara means high class and asan means sitting place. So he got up from there. Khadgam. He took a sword and got up from there. Pragriyo utpatita. He took his sword up and he also stood up. He got up from his seat. And sthambam. That sthamba that Prahlad Maharaj had pointed towards. Swamushtina. With his own mushti. With his own fist. What did he do? Satada, atti balaha, with very lot of strength, he hit the pillar. When he hit the pillar and he said, now let me see where your Vishnu comes from. Let me see where your Vishnu comes from. And when he hit the pillar with his hand, Shukdev Goswami describes at that time, tadaiva tasmin ninadoti bhishano babhuva yenanda kata hamasputat yam vai swadishnyo pagatam majadaya shrutva swadhamatyayam mangane mire. Tadaiva, at that time what happened? Tasmin, from that pillar, ninado ati bhishano, a loud cracking sound came from that pillar. And babhuva, it came in such a way as if andakataham asputan, as if the whole material shell is breaking. That was the sound that came from that pillar. Bhukhandam varanandam parabara biratam dampa dampuru dampam dim 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 dahamapi dahamai jampa jampaisha jampai tulyas tulyas tutulya dhuma dhuma dhumakai kum kumankai kumankai etatte purna yuktam maharaharaha patumam narasimham garjantam garjayantam nijapuja patalam sphotayantam hatantam rupyantam tapayantam divi bhuviditijam kshepayantam kshipantam krandantam roshayantam dishi dishi satatam samharantam bharantam vikshantam purnayantam karanikara shatair divya simham namami. Aha. A cracking sound came, a loud sound which had never been heard in the history of mankind. The roar, the cracking sound was as if andakatahamasputan, as if the whole material shell is cracking. And at that time, what happened? Yamvaiswa dishnyopagatam ajadaya. All the demigods headed by Brahma, they ran to their own rooms, thinking that now finished. They started telling each other, my planet is going to go now. Our planet is all sinking. It's the time of pralay. And Shrutva, hearing Swadhamatyayam Anga me nire, they started yelling and screaming. Demigods, they themselves didn't know Vishnu's appearing. They ran here, there, everywhere. And at that time, Shukadeva Goswami is saying, what happened next after that? Savikramam putra vadepsurojasa nishamya nirladam apurvam adbhutam antasabhayam nadadarsha tatpadam vitatrasur yena surari yutapa. Hiranyakashipu is observing. Hiranyakashipu is observing what is happening at this point. What is happening? Hiranyakashipu is seeing. So Vikraman Putra Vadepsur Ojasa, when he jumped on his son to kill him, Vada Ipsu, he was desiring to kill his son Ojasa with all strength, Vikraman with valor, when he jumped in his assembly, at that time what happened? Nishamya Nirladam Apurvam Adbhutam. He heard a roar, a Nirladam or a Nirladam. He heard Nishamya, he heard a Nirlada roar, a sound, Apurvam Adbhutam. Adbhutam means astonishing, Apurva means never heard before. He heard this sound which was too loud and it was fear-inducing. And from where did it come? He started looking around, where is the sound coming from? Antaha Sabhayam, it came from his own Sabha, from his assembly. Na dadarsha tatpadam, never seen before. And vitatrasu yena surari yutapa. Hiranyakashipu, who never fears anything or anyone, got scared just by the sound of the roar. He had not even seen what that is from. And at that time, when he is trying to see where this is coming from, in text 17, Shukdev Goswami says, Satyam vidhatum nija bhritya bhashitam vyaptim cha bhuteshu akhileshu chatmanah adrishya tatyad bhutarupam udvahan stambe sabhayam namrigam namanusham. Hiranyakashipu is looking around. Where is the sound coming from? He is already afraid without seeing the form. And at that time, Shukadev Goswami says, Satyam vidhatum nija vritya bhashitam. Only to make his devotee's words come true. Which devotee? Prahlad. Prahlad just pointed at that pillar. Satyam vidhatum, just to make that to be truth. That Lord Vyaptim, who's present everywhere, he could have come from anywhere. He comes from the womb of Mother Devaki. He comes from the womb of Kaushalya Devi. He comes from the womb of Shachi Mata. As Varaha Devi, he comes from the nostrils of Brahma. Vyaptim, he's present everywhere. Akhileshu Chatmana, he's present outside. He can break a door. He can break the cosmic creation. He can come through the sky. He can come in so many ways. He can come as Varahadev. He can come as Kurmadev. He can come as Matsyavatar. But because Prahlad pointed to that pillar, Satyam Vidhatum, only to make those words come true, Nija Bhritya Bhashitam, my devotee who has struggled so much for me, Bhashitam, he has said, therefore Satyam Vidhatum, only to make that as truth, the supreme absolute truth, he appeared. Adrishyata, he came in a form which was never seen before. Ati Adbhuta Rupam, it was a form which was astonishingly beautiful. It was astonishingly horrifying. It was astonishingly magical. It was never seen before. What kind of form is this? Where are the nails coming from? How many hands does he have? What are these weapons? Where is the roar coming from? How is the chest that of a human? How is the neck that of a human? How are the mane and the hair from the face of a lion coming on the body of a human? What is this going on? Stambe. He came from the pillar, that same pillar that Hiranyakashipu punched, that same pillar that Prahlad pointed towards, Sabhayam. Where did he come? He came in Hiranyakashipu's Sabha. Na mrigam, na manusham. Hiranyakashipu is looking. He's saying, this is a mriga. This is a lion. Then he looks. He says, no, no, this is a human. Then he says, na mrigam. No, no, this is not a lion. Na manusham. No, no, this is not a human. Satyam vidhatum nijabhritya bhashitam vyaptim cha bhuteshu akhileshu chatmanaha adrishyatat ati adbhuta rupam udvahan stambe sabhayam namrigam namanushamaha. Srimad Bhagavatam, Shukdev Goswami is dripping nectar through these words. He is saying, in the pillar that Prahlad pointed, in the same assembly that Hiranyakashipu was sitting, the Supreme Lord came in a form which was never seen before. And Satyam Vidhatum, how many devotees' words he made true with that same appearance. He made the words of Prahlad come true, that this is the pillar. He made the words of Brahmaji come true. Brahmaji said, neither inside, nor outside, nor man, nor animal. Man, hands or weapons, day or night, inside or outside, not in the sky, not on the floor, fulfilling all those conditions of Brahmaji. The Supreme Lord, who is controlled by so many devotees, he kept everybody's words. He kept the words. He kept the words of Prahlad Maharaj. He kept the words of Brahmaji. He kept the words of the four Kumaras. The four Kumaras told Jay and Vijay, Vishnu will come and uplift you, when they were cursed in the first place. To keep their words come true, the Supreme Lord appeared, because Hiranyakashipu, after all, is Hiranyakashipu and Hiranyaksha are Jay and Vijay for the Supreme Lord. Adbhutam, really Adbhutam. Half man, half lion was never seen before. Animal forms were seen, human forms were seen. The Supreme Lord can appear like a dwarf. The Supreme Lord can appear like Krishna or Ramachandra or Parashuram. He can appear like Matsya and Kurma. But this combination was never seen. This is Adbhutam. The demigods started saying, we know the Supreme Lord so well, we go to his abode, but still we didn't know such a form exists in his eternal abode. 18. Sa sattvamenam parito vipashyan sthambasya madhyat anunirjahinam nayam mrigo napinaro vichitram aho kimetad nrumrgendra rupam. Hiranyakashipu is now thinking. Sa sattvam enam parito vipashyan. Narad Muni is speaking that Hiranyakashipu vipashyan, he started seeing. Pashya means to see. Vipashya, vishesha rupena pashyan. He really started seeing, what is this? Sa sattvam enam parito. Parita means outside, in all directions. He started seeing, what is this? I have never seen anything like this. I have never seen limbs like this. I have never seen hair and chest and teeth and nails and body so distinct and directly dangerous like this. And sthambasya madhyat anunirjihaham hanam. He came straight from the pillar in my assembly. I made my assembly with my own hands and my men. I know what is where. I made these pillars, but we didn't fit him in the pillar. How did he come from my pillar? Sthambasya madhyat, he came from there. Oh, nayam mrigo napi naro vichitram. What is this? This is na ayam mriga. This is not mriga. Na api nara. This is not nara. This is not lion. This is not animal. Vichitram. This is something else only. Aho kim etat. Hiranyakashipu shouting, what is this? Who is this? Where did this come from? Nru mrigendra rupam. He is certainly nru. He is human. Mrigendra, lion. Oh, what is this going on? Mimamsamanasya samutthito grato. After Mimamsam, after he analyzed all this, as he was thinking, samutthito agrato, the Supreme Lord came towards Narsingadev. As he appeared, he came towards Hiranyakashipu. And Rasimha rupas tadalam bhayanakam prataptam chami karachandalochanam spurat shatake sharajambitananam. Very, very beautiful description of the Supreme Lord has been described in text 20. 19, 20, 21, 22. Everyone please pay attention. Very beautiful. Mimamsa manasya samusthito grato. The Supreme Lord came close. As Hiranyakashipu was analyzing, what form is this? The Supreme Lord came ahead. Nrisimha rupastad alam bhayanaka. It was very, very scary. This form came. The nails were coming out so long. They were not shaped or they were not cut. They were so big. And there were hundreds and hundreds of hands. With weapons, filled with weapons. Look at this form. Pratapta chami karachanda lochanam. His eyes were like molten gold. It was like lava. It was like red, red hot, big eyes, chandalochanam. And spurat shata keshara jhrambitananam. Hair from his face on the mane, the neck was thick and short. And his facial hair was all over the neck. And, you know, the mane was covered with hair, and at the same time jhrumbitananam, he was opening his mouth and showing the whole world. And what was he showing? Karala damstram karavala chanchala kshuranta jivvam bhrikuti mukholmanam. Karala damstram. Narsingadev was opening his mouth loud and roaring, and the teeth, canine teeth inside, were so scary. His mouth was this wide open. And he was roaring. He was deafening Hiranyakashipu. And when he was looking, it was blinding his eyes, the effulgence. And when he looked, the teeth were so sharp, ready to rip flesh. And at the same time, Karaval Chanchala Huranta Jivham. His tongue was very sharp and it was moving like a sword. When someone is fighting with a sword, that's how his tongue was moving. Jibha. He was moving like that. And it was like a sword because a sword, when it is covered with blood, that's how the tongue was. The tongue was red, it was thick, and it was moving so fast. And Brukuti Mukholmanam, his Brukuti, his eyebrows were also deadly, and they were moving with so much anger. And Stabda Urdhva Karanam Girikandar Adbhutam, his ears were stiff, and they were Urdhvam, they were facing upwards, Karanam, ears. And Girikandar Adbhutam, Vyatasya Nasam Hanubheda Bhishanam. Hanu means chin, you know, Hanuman, when he was hit. So Hanubheda, his jaw was Bhishanam, opening so big, and his nose and his mouth were like caves of a mountain, very, very big. And at the same time, Divi Sprushat Kayamadirga Pivara. When Narsingadeva was moving his body, such a big form, Divi Sprushat, it was touching the sky. Almost the demigods were being touched, Kayam. His body was a Dirga Pivara. So body was Dirga and his neck was short. Body was very long. It was touching in all directions. People were running in the sky. And his neck was short and thick. Grivoru Vakshas, Thalamalpa Madhyama, chest was very big and his waist was very thin. Chandramshu Gaurish Churitam Tanoruhair. How was the hair on his body and how was his complexion? It was lit up like the moonbeams. Vishwak Bhujani Kashatam Nakhayudam. His hands were almost ripping the universe. Vishwak Bhujanik Shatam, hundreds and hundreds of hands of Narsingadev, and Nakha Ayudam, and the weapons on the hands were Nakha, nails, or Athava, there were nails on the end, and at the same time, they were holding. The nails were there, but they were also holding Chakra, and Gada, and sword, and shield, and bow, and arrow, and so many conch shell and Padma, so many things were there. Durasadam Sarva Nijeturadhuya. Durasadam, nobody could go close to him. Sarva Nija, whoever had Ayudha, they had their own Ayudha. They tried to get all of that, but it was very difficult to go close to him. Praveka Vidra Vita Daitya Danavam. All the Daityas, all the Danavas, they became Vidravita. They became very, very scared. They didn't know what to do. Hiranyakashipu standing and thinking, this is Vishnu, I think definitely this is Vishnu. Others are running in fear for their life, and Hiranyakashipu was so fearless that he was standing there and he was definitely convinced that this is Vishnu. And at that time, Shukadev Goswami says that Hiranyakashipu is so fearless that he was saying, people say Hari, 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 I know this Hari. He makes all this Mayavi makeup. Sometimes he comes like a boar, sometimes he comes like a lion. What drama is this? Just to save himself from me, he thinks that by this makeup, this drama, this maya, the word used by Shukadeva Goswami is Harina Uru Maina. Hari has come with this big maik form. So much makeup and so much drama and newer costumes that he has put in. He thinks whatever he is planning, he will fulfill. Now look what I do. I will do vad. I will kill him. Evam bruvams. Saying this, Abhyapatat, he jumped on Narsingadev Gadayudha. He jumped with his Gada. He jumped with his club as an Ayudha. And at that time what happened? Nadan Rasimham Pratidaitya Kunjara. He jumped with a roar. And Narsingadev was also roaring. And it was as if an elephant jumped towards a lion to say, please eat me up. And when he jumped towards Narsingadev, at that time Shukadeva Goswami says, Alakshitognao patita patangamo. It was like a patanga, it was like a firefly which enthusiastically jumps into the fire. Meaning one, fire is going to eat up the firefly. Narsingadev was going to kill Hiranyakashipu. Meaning number two, the firefly is not even seen in front of the fire. Hiranyakashipu was not even seen. He, by whose movement of his eyebrows everyone trembled, in front of Narsingadev, Hiranyakashipu was not even seen. He lost all his effulgence and all his form. Alakshitognao patita patangamo yathan rasimho jasiso surastada. The ojas shakti of Narsinga was so much that Hiranyakashipu could not do anything. At that time, Narad Muni says, this is not something that is astonishing. Na tad vichitram khalu sattvadhamani svatejasayo nu purapibhattama. He is that same Lord Narsingadev who before creation there is darkness all over and he sips that darkness by creating. Before there is only tamas, but he creates everything. He can, that is his stage. He has light even when there is total darkness. So what is so astonishing that he has more Ojas Shakti than Hiranyakashipu. And at that time, Shukdev Goswami says, on one side was Narsingadev, on the other side was Mahasura. Rushan Rishimham Gadayuru Veghaya. Hiranyakashipu with Gada, with his club, with great speed, he went towards Narsinga, who was Rusha, who had so much anger. And Tam Vikramantam. Sa gadam gadadharo. What did Narsingadev do? With one hand he held the club. With the other hand he held the gadadhara, the holder of the club. And Shukdev Goswami gives the example, Maha uragam tarksha suto yatha grahit. Just like Garuda catches snakes and rips them and kills them. Similarly, Narsingadev held Hiranyakashipu. He held the gada with one hand. He held Hiranyakashipu with the other. And at that time, Shukdev Goswami says, as this went on, he held him for some time and then at that time Hiranyakashipu was trying to move so much. So Narsingadev let him go. Just like sometimes Garuda, he may leave the snakes and then catch them again. But the snakes think, ah, see, Garuda could not catch me. So Hiranyakashipu was thinking, he couldn't hold me. I was trying my bit, so he got scared. Narsingadev got scared. So tasya hastot kalitastad asurah, when he slipped out from the hands of Narsingadev, Narsingadev thought, now I will play with him. Vikriditoh yatvat ahir garutmata. Narsingadev thought, vikriditam, let me play with him, just like Garud plays with the snakes. And at that time, Prabhupada writes in the purport, this is the nature of Krishna. However demoniac we are, Krishna will let us slip out, giving us a second chance. Demigods at that time thought, this is not good. Hiranyakashipu should not be let free. We should not give him another chance. And as Hiranyakashipu was thinking, that Narsingadev got scared of his strength, and now that I am free, Punastama sajjata khadga charmani pragrihya vegena gata shramo mrude. Bhagavatam describes, he jumped out and he took his khadga. Khadga means sword, and he took a shield also. He took and Narad Muni says, gata shrama. Because of that break, Hiranyakashipu's tiredness, shrama, gata, it went. His fear also went away, his tiredness also went away, and he attacked Narsingadev with more speed. He attacked like a hawk tries to attack. But Narsingadev is the lord of Garuda. So he knows how to play with such snakes. Charantam achidram upari ado harihi. He was jumping around Hiranyakashipu, charantam, achidram, faultless in his fighting. Upari, sometimes up, adaha, sometimes down. He was sitting down and attacking. Sometimes he was jumping. He was moving in circles and trying to hit. Narsingadev tolerated him for some time. And at that time, krutvata hasam. Narsingadev started laughing very loudly, roaring. And again, it was so intense. He roared so loudly that nimilitaksham jagrihe mahajavaha, that Hiranyakashipu's eyes shut just by hearing the roar. And when that happened, when he closed his eyes, Narsingadev held the neck of Hiranyakashipu, and this time he decided, now I will not let him go. Vishvakspurantam grihananturam hari. He held him and he pressed him. Grihanaturam, he started squeezing Hiranyakashipu. And vyalo yathakum kulishakshatatvacham. It has been described that kulisha means thunderbolt. Indra's thunderbolt did not bring a scratch to the body of Hiranyakashipu. And that Hiranyakashipu now was being squeezed like a snake squeezes a mouse in its strangulated position, coils. So what that means is Hiranyakashipu was like a mouse. And Narsingadev, like a snake, was strangulating him. And just like a mouse would do, quick, 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 for help, Hiranyakashipu was trying to speak something. Let me go, please let me go. But Narsingadev, you know, he caught him like a snake catches a mouse. And Hiranyakashipu, who cannot be scratched even by the thunderbolt attacks of Indra, he was being squeezed to death by Narsingadev. And at that time, what did Narsingadev do? Dwari Urumapatya Dara Leelaya. He took him to the door, which was neither inside the house nor outside the house. And he placed him on the lap, which is neither the sky nor the floor, in sunset time, which is neither the day nor at night, in a form which was neither man nor lion. And he took his nakha, nails, which are neither hands nor weapons. Nakhai yathahim garudo mahavisham. He took his nails as weapons. And what did he do? Samrambam dushprekshakarala lochano. With eyes which are so intense, with so much anger, he put the nails through the abdomen of Hiranyakashipu and started tearing him to pieces with so much anger, with so many hands. And at that time, Sridhar Swami says that the example given is, Narsingadev held Hiranyakashipu like a snake holds the mouse, but he tore him like how Garuda tears snakes. So two examples have been given: Garuda, snake, snake, mouse. So he held Hiranyakashipu like snake holds a mouse, and he tore him like Garuda tears snakes. And he was Dushpreksha Karala Lochana. Nobody could look at his eyes. Vyatananantam Vilihan Swajivhaya Vilihan. He was licking the ends, the antam of his wide mouth with his tongue. He was licking through the ends of his mouth. He was licking the blood splash from the body of Hiranyakashipu all over his face. And not just that, Shukdev Goswami described Astrig Lavakta Runakesharan Kesharanano. He says his face was such that Kesharanano, his face, his mane, his hair was all red, dripping. Blood was dripping because he was eating from the abdomen, like a lion eats, and there was blood dripping all over the face. The hair was completely red. We should not think that the Supreme Lord has become dirty because he is Parampavitram. Purusham Bhavan. Arjuna has said, you are the most complete Lord, purest Lord. And at that time, Antramali, Yathantramali Dvipahatyaya Hari. Just like a lion rips an elephant and pulls out its intestines, that's how Narsingadev was like a lion and Hiranyakashipu was like an elephant. You see how so many metaphors and examples have been given through such horrifying graphic descriptions. And Narsingadev pulled out the intestines, the antramali, and made a garland and he put. So he who's vanamali in Vrindavan, to someone who offends his devotees, he becomes antramali. He rips the intestines and wears a garland. And not just that, he was still not happy. After that, he started tearing the chest of Hiranyakashipu. And after he tore the chest, he put his hand in and pulled out the heart of Hiranyakashipu, looked at the heart and threw it towards the followers of Hiranyakashipu. And Shukdev Goswami at that time, or Narad Muni also at that time, they say, Nakankurotpatita rit saroruham. The heart of Hiranyakashipu, the Supreme Lord ripped like an elephant rips a lotus. How easily? Or the heart is compared to a lotus because Hiranyakashipu heart is supposed to be lotus where I am supposed to sit. How dirty you made your heart. And he ripped his abdomen, put the intestine garland around, ripped the chest, took the heart around and threw. And it is described at that time, Visrijya tasya anucharan, to anucharan, to those followers of Hiranyakashipu, to them he threw. And at that time, what did they do? Aham samasta nakashastra panibhi. They said, hey, this is the heart of, look how he's misbehaving with our Lord. They all raised their hands. They raised all their shastras. Thousands and thousands of kshatriyas started fighting Narsingadev. And it is described, Dordanda yuto nupathan sahasrashah. Narsingadev with his thousand hands, he ripped everybody to pieces. For some of them, he was scratching them to death. For some of them, he was biting and pulling and tearing them to death. For some of them, he was kicking with his lotus feet. For some of them, with his chakra. For some of them, he was strangulating in his arms. And rivers of blood were flowing in the assembly of Hiranyakashipu's kingdom. The hair of Narsingadev, of his head, was shaking the clouds and it scattered everything. His glaring eyes, it stole the effulgence of the sun and the moon. His breathing was agitating the oceans. And as Nrsimhadev was roaring, elephants were running for their life in fear, thinking that some lion has come. Even after all of this, when Nrsimhadev was looking around, he looked up and the demigods who were watching, they started moving with their airplanes, thinking that now he's going to chase us. And Nrsimhadev with his feet, he was hitting it on Mother Earth because he wanted to fight more. And Mother Earth slipped down from her orbit because of the hitting of Nrsimhadev's feet. And by the roaring of Nrsimhadev, the hills started cracking and rocks started falling down. And all the sky and all the celestial beings, they lost their effulgence in front of Nrsimhadev. He wanted to fight more and more and more and more, but there was no one left. There was no one left. He wanted to fight, but everyone's dead. There's no one around. Demigods want to come and welcome him with a garland, but they're scared. So he went and sat, breathing very heavily, blood dripping around. This is the love of the Supreme Lord towards one devotee, dear devotees. This is how much the Supreme Lord loves one devotee. Each one of us is so dear to the Supreme Lord like Prahlad. When the more we perform bhakti, the more we realize it. That's all. The Lord loves us so much. He's ready to come in a form. You see, every incarnation, the Lord comes in a form like Ramachandra, Krishna, etc. You know, which will always be remembered. Everyone will take photographs and start writing about that incarnation. But instead of thinking of how I look, he broke the pillar and fought with so much virras just to protect one devotee. And he still wanted to fight and he's breathing. It's like a father who fought for his son, breathing so heavily, so tired with this fight. No one to welcome him. And he went and sat on the throne of Hiranyakashipu. Why? Because anyway, the throne is called Simhasana. Hiranyakashipu thought he was the lion, but when the true lion came, the true Simha came, he came and sat on the asana. Also to say that Atithi must be given some sitting place when they come to our house. For Prahlad Maharaj, for us we say Atithi Devo Bhava, but for Prahlad Maharaj, Deva himself came as Atithi, as the guest. So we should give a sitting place. Nrsimhadev offered sitting place to himself. And then also with the feeling that after all, what is Hiranyakashipu's is mine, because he is my eternal associate. And when this was going on, Nrsimhadev was sitting and breathing heavily with no one to fight. The clouds started clearing slowly. Two meanings. The gloomy climate of Hiranyakashipu's rule was clearing. Or another meaning, Nrsimhadev wanted the whole world to have darshan of this Ugra form. The clouds which were stopping that darshan were moving. And Nrsimhadev gave darshan to everyone. Nishamya lokatraya mastakajwaram tamadi daityam harina hatamride praharsha vegot kalitananamuhu prasuna varshai vavrishu surastriya. And at that time, the mastakajwara, the headache of the whole world, Hiranyakashipu, he was lokatraya mastakajwara. He was the headache for the whole world. The fact that hatam, he is finally gone. Previously also they thought he is gone, but he was covered by anthill. He was still alive. But now when they came and saw that he is really gone, that daityam is gone. So what did the demigods do? Praharsha bhavena. They became very, very happy. And with lot of eagerness, they started prasuna varsha. They started showering flowers from the sky. The apsaras were dancing. The gandharvas were singing. The suras and the asuras both. So asuras, those who were alive, they hid. And suras, demigods also, they kept distance. Nobody came close. But from that distance, they started playing instruments and prayers and offering flowers. No one came close. Later, the Bhagavatam describes many personalities came. Brahma came, Shivji came, Indra came, Rishis came, Pitrugana came, Siddhas came, Charanas came, Vidyadharas came, Nagas came, everyone came. And finally, they went close to the Supreme Lord, offered prayers. But Nrsimhadev would not be pacified. Lakshmi Devi was invited. She also could not pacify. She said, I am not going close to him. If he uses his nails, now I will be dead. He's in a very ferocious mood. And that same Prahlad, who was the only cause of Nrsimhadev's appearance, when Prahlad Maharaj went and spoke, Nrsimhadev smiled and he had tears of affection looking at his child. The nails conquered the world, but the palm of paternal affection protected Prahlad. And he lifted Prahlad and kept him on his lap and embraced him. That, my child, you belong only to me. So in this way, dear devotees, today is a very, very auspicious day. That Nrsimhadev has appeared for us. He has appeared breaking the pillar of Hiranyakashipu's pride to protect the Prahlad of our bhakti and to rip apart the anartha like Hiranyakashipu in our heart. I really want to thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity to serve Harikatha and serve all the assembled Vaishnavas and Vaishnavis. I really want to thank all the assembled Vaishnavas and Vaishnavis for being attentive and tolerating me for such a long time. You have not moved and you're sitting and listening. I really want to thank all of you. I want to thank my Gurudev, my dear beloved spiritual master from whom I heard this Harikatha. I want to offer my obeisances to Srila Prabhupada, who gifted word-to-word translation, full translation and purport to each of these verses, and also spoke elaborately on the seventh canto in English for the whole world to give an entrance into this Prahlad Narsingha Leela. Narsingha Dev Bhagavan ki jai, Prahlad Charitra ki jai, Hiranyakashipu Vad Leela ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Gaur Premanande, Hari Hari Bol.